Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents From the Realm of a Dying Sun, Volume 2, 4th SS Panzer Corps from Budapest to Vienna, December 1944 to May 1945, by Douglas E. Nash, Sr., narrated by David DeVries. Introduction. This is the second of three volumes which together trace the history of the 4th SS Panzer Corps from its inception until the end of the war. The first volume focused on the activation of the Corps, its structure and organization, leadership, and the history of its two Corps divisions, the 3rd SS Panzerdivision Totenkopf and the 5th SS Panzerdivision Wiking. It then traced the history of the Corps after its introduction to battle on 28 July 1944, its participation in the massive tank battle of Praga, its role in the three defensive battles of Warsaw, and ended on 26 November 1944 with the siege of Modlin and the transfer of the Corps to 2nd Armee. The first volume described some of the heaviest fighting ever witnessed on the Eastern Front, which forged the 4th SS Panzer Corps into a responsive and lethal instrument of war. This phase of the Corps' history, which began with its participation in a highly mobile, fluid battle, ended with its troops engaged in static trench warfare reminiscent of World War I. This second volume picks up at the end of November 1944, where the first left off, with the Corps still engaged in defending the so-called Wet Triangle, that tactically significant chunk of terrain situated between the Narev and Vistula rivers. Seemingly relegated to a secondary front, the Corps was jolted out of its holiday preparations when the Oberkommando der Wehrmacht, OKW, ordered it to begin moving by rail to another theater of operations on Christmas Eve. Thus would begin the final phase of the war in the East, with the Corps once again called upon to carry out one of the most audacious attacks of World War II, the relief of an encircled city. During the seesaw fighting that ensued, the 4th SS Panzer Corps, along with a large number of other German army divisions, sought in vain to relieve the embattled garrison of Budapest and to re-establish the old front line along the lower Danube. The final volume in this trilogy will focus on the last 3 months of the war, which witnessed not only the Third Reich's last large-scale offensive of the war, Operation Frühlingserwachsen, Spring Awakening, but the Red Army's Vienna operation, which drove German and Hungarian forces out of Hungary and deep into southeastern Austria, as well as the fall of Vienna. Volume 3 will conclude with a last-minute surrender by the 4th SS Panzer Corps to U.S. forces along the Enns River on 9 May 1945, and the post-war fate of some of its members. In the first volume, the author had access to the nearly complete war diaries of Heeresgruppe Mitte and the 2nd and 9th Armee for July until the end of November 1944, as well as those of SS Panzerregiment 5 and 1st Abteilung SS Panzerregiment 5. In drafting the second volume, he encountered a paucity of primary sources from units of the 4th SS Panzer Corps due to the destruction of official records at the field army level and below for the period encompassing December 1944 until the end of the war. Ironically, the Kriegsarchiv, wartime archive of the Waffen-SS in Sessmuk, had reprimanded the Corps' 2A, its adjutant or chief personnel officer, on 16 January 1945 for his failure to submit the Corps' annual historical report and all of the related material, such as its war diaries, records of tank assaults, etc., for archiving. Involved as he and the rest of the Korpsstab were at that time in the relief of Budapest, it is understandable that Sturmbannführer Karl Willy Schulze failed to meet the deadline. But one wonders what happened to all of the Corps' historical material or whether it was delivered to the Kriegsarchiv der Waffen-SS at all. Consequently, with a few exceptions, the author has had to rely on a number of secondary sources, some of which are unit histories written after the war by participants in the campaign, while others, such as Christian Ungvari's The Siege of Budapest, 100 Days in World War II, were composed by military historians using such records that survived the war. The primary sources consulted for this book include an electronic copy of the War Diary, or Kriegstagebuch, KTB, of Heeresgruppe Süd, or Army Group South, Führungsabteilung, Operations Section, the headquarters responsible for planning and coordinating German operations in Hungary, which covers the period from 1 February to the end of March 1945. Heeresgruppe Süd was the higher headquarters two levels above the 4th SS Panzer Corps, so it primarily concerns the actions and activities of the 3 to 4 German and 1 Hungarian field armies under its command, and not individual corps. Therefore, events happening at the lowest tactical level of the division, regiment, and battalion have been filtered somewhat by the need to simplify and reduce the amount of information being sent from frontline units up the chain of command. The KTB used includes 3 separate sections: the summarized daily KTB, the Meldungen, daily reports of the subordinate armies and other major subordinate units, as well as various command-related Befehle, orders, other reports, troop strength, armor strength, proclamations, and so forth, totaling thousands of pages of documents. Another source recently uncovered in the Germans' record cache in Moscow and published online by the German-Russian consortium Deutsch-Russisches Projekt zur Digitalisierung deutscher Dokumente in Archiven der Russischen Föderation, also known as the German Documents in Russia website, include several hundred pages of captured reports, situation maps, and messages from Armeegruppe Balk, 6th Armee, for the entire months of December 1944 and January 1945, leading into the first week of February 1945. Unfortunately, this hoard of documents does not include its KTB, but instead incorporates what was usually included in a separate annex to the KTB in a folder normally titled Meldungen und Befehle, Reports and Orders. Still, it is an extremely valuable resource because it includes weekly personnel readiness reports stating each unit's Kampfstärke, as well as armored vehicle and anti-tank gun availability with Armeegruppe Balk 6th Armee, including Hungarian units. This cache of captured documents also includes the complete daily intelligence reports compiled by the 6th Armee 1C staff officer for the entire month of January 1945, which provides a detailed, day-by-day description of the operations carried out by each corps under its command, including the 4th SS Panzer Corps, as well as the air situation and assessments of Soviet plans and activities. In this manner, it is similar to the 1A KTB, though not as detailed or as comprehensive. Another equally valuable resource contained within this archive are the full-color daily situation maps in either 1 to 200,000 or 1 to 300,000 scale maintained by the Armeegruppe Balk 6th Armee 1A from 28 November 1944 until 31 January 1945, that depict the location of all the units under its command, including Hungarian units, as well as the position of the German front line on any given day. Some maps also depict suspected locations of Soviet units and the directions of their attacks. While this proved to be an invaluable source, it is unfortunate that information for December 1944 and January 1945 was all that survived intact. In toto, this records grouping proved to be an invaluable source that contains many documents submitted by or pertaining to the 4th SS Panzer Corps for the month of January 1945 that would have been destroyed had the Red Army not overtaken a portion of the Armeegruppe Balk 6th Armee's staff caravan transporting them before the war ended. Another long-overlooked primary German source has recently become available thanks to the efforts of Mr. Perry Pyrick, who referenced the 4th SS Panzer Corps in his own book, published 24 years ago, Hungary, 1944-1945, The Forgotten Tragedy, Aspect Books, 1996. Written in December 1981 by the former Chief of Staff of the 4th SS Panzer Corps, Manfred Schönfelder, this account, Einsatz der Verbände der Waffen-SS auf dem Kriegsschauplatz in Ungarn in der Zeit vom 1,1-31 März 1945, Actions of the Units of the Waffen-SS in the Hungarian Theater of War from 1 January to 31 March 1945, is a 22-page manuscript based on his post-war notes that was written as a point-by-point rebuttal against accusations leveled at Hermann Balck, the former commander of Armeegruppe Balck, 6th Armee. In his memoirs, Order in Chaos, Balck makes the case that the 4th SS Panzer Corps and its commander were responsible for the failure to relieve Budapest, and not Balck's own defective leadership. In addition to setting the historical record straight, Schönfelder also provides an excellent daily account of the Corps' activities during this same time frame, shedding additional light upon a period of the war not generally understood in the West. In addition to Mr. Pyrick's work, several other works stand out in their thoroughness of the coverage of this phase of the war, with particular attention being paid to the role played by the 4th SS Panzer Corps. The first is an eyewitness account written by the late Georg Meyer, Drama between Budapest and Vienna, the Final Battles of the 6th Panzer Armee in the East, 1945. This excellent work of military history covers the campaign in great detail, focusing on the period from the end of December 1944 until the end of the war. Meyer, a Kriegsakademie-trained general staff officer and the former 1A, or operations officer, of SS-Oberstgruppenführer Sepp Dietrich's 6th Panzer Armee, was a friend of fellow Kriegsakademie graduate Manfred Schönfelder. As such, Meyer was in a good position as a general staff officer to observe the events as they unfolded from an operational perspective. Consequently, his work is primarily concerned with the actions of 6th Panzer Armee and neighboring units during this final phase of the war. But the 4th SS Panzer Corps receives its fair share of attention, especially concerning the controversy between Generals Balck and Gille during the three relief attempts of Budapest, Unternehmen Konrad 1-3. Buttressed by no fewer than 130 appendices, most of which consist of reproduced contemporary documents as well as 30 original maps, this immense study, appearing first in German in 1984 and translated into English by J.J. Fedorowicz Publishing in 2005, is absolutely essential for anyone desiring to study the war in Hungary in general and the role played by Hitler's elite SS divisions in particular. Another extremely useful primary source is the contemporary personal diary kept by the O1, Assistant Operations Officer of the Viking Division, Obersturmführer Gunther Janke. As an aspiring General Staff Officer himself, Janke was being groomed to become a Division 1A someday after he had attended the Kriegsakademie. Possessing a sharp memory and the self-discipline to continue making entries in his diary until the end of the war, Janke's account is extremely invaluable in helping the historian understand what was going on behind the scenes in the division's leadership circles, adding details that often escape the drafting of official reports submitted up the chain of command. Another important primary source is the personal notes kept by Obergruppenführer Gille himself, although his name is found nowhere on the document. For years, it resided in the Viking Division's Truppenkameradschaft, Veterans Association archives, which were donated to the Bundesarchiv Militärarchiv in Freiburg several years ago. Based on the formal style of writing, the old-world, early 20th century military terminology used, and the perspective that could only have been held by a senior officer in command, including referring to himself in the third person, a number of Waffen-SS historians consulted for this volume agreed that the only person in a senior-level position that could have written this document was Herbert Gille himself. Although only 4 pages long, it covers in shorthand form the events experienced by the 4th SS Panzer Corps from 24 December 1944 to 30 March 1945, with a large gap appearing between that and the last entry of 8 May 1945. Especially valuable are the personal insights he provides about contemporary events and details of operational matters. A companion to Gille, Meyer, and Janke's accounts is the final volume of Wolfgang Wopasal's Soldaten, Kämpfer, Kameraden, the magisterial 6-volume history of the 3rd SS Panzer Division Totenkopf, an 8-year project that began in 1983. Like Meyer, Wuppersal frequently references the Heeresgruppe Süd war diary, Soviet sources, and existing records of the Totenkopf and Viking divisions, as well as hundreds of individual accounts by surviving members of the division. Volume 5b, which the author consulted extensively for this book, traces the history of the division from the fall of 1944 until the end of war, when it was handed over en masse by the U.S. Army to the Red Army as prisoners of war, an ordeal from which many of its men did not return until the release of all former German POWs in 1955. Wuppersal's account remains to date the most detailed and factual description of this controversial division, which outgrew its concentration camp origins and developed into one of the most lethally effective divisions in the Waffen-SS. Another groundbreaking work frequently referenced in this manuscript, written from the American military perspective, is the transcript of proceedings from the 1986 Art of War Symposium conducted by the U.S. Army War College's Center for Land Warfare, From the Vistula to the Oder, Soviet Offensive Operations, October 1944 to March 1945. Consisting of a series of presentations and lectures delivered over 5 days during July 1986 to the faculty and student body of the War College, it featured guest speakers from the former Soviet Union, Great Britain, the United States, and no fewer than 10 former officers of the Wehrmacht and the Waffen-SS then serving in or recently retired from the Bundeswehr, who had been participants in the fighting in and around Budapest and Vienna. This work, the third volume in a series studying the war in the East from 1941 to 1945, covers in detail the fighting in Hungary, Poland, East Prussia, and Berlin, comprising the final phase of the war in Europe. Brilliantly directed and edited by noted Sovietologist Colonel, retired, David M. Glantz, the proceedings from this seminar, incorporated into an 803-page masterpiece, contain 416 maps, charts, and organizational diagrams that make it invaluable for the study of the final phase of the Red Army's operations against Nazi Germany. The copies of actual Red Army daily situation maps depicting the actions and unit locations of the divisions, corps, and armies of the 2nd and 3rd Ukrainian fronts, as well as German units from October 1944 until the end of the war, are definitive and allow the author to verify the accuracy of contemporary German operational maps. The other work frequently cited in this work is Norbert Schamweber's The Sword Behind the Shield, A Combat History of the German Efforts to Relieve Budapest 1945, Operation Conrad 1, 2, and 3, the English-language edition that was published in 2015 by Helion & Company after first appearing in Hungary 2 years before. A thoroughly researched and documented study, the author brilliantly illuminates the heavy fighting that ensued when 4th SS Panzerkorps carried out its three relief attempts of Budapest, followed by the initial February 1945 Soviet counteroffensive that occurred in the wake of the Germans' failure to relieve the city. As much a study in tactics, technology, and command and control as it is a history of the fighting, Schamweber displays his extensive knowledge of German, Soviet, and Hungarian source material, which he puts to good use in telling his story. Though not a unit history of the 4th SS Panzer Corps per se, Schamweber's work is a must-have for anyone seriously attempting to study in detail the operations that unfolded during the first 5 weeks of 1945. In this work, he has provided a wealth of information and analysis about the 4th SS Panzer Corps, which is unavailable anywhere else. The works by Pyrrhic, Meyer, Glantz, and Schamweber have been frequently consulted during the drafting of this book, and the author is indebted to all four in crafting this history of the 4th SS Panzer Corps. Another recently published study that devotes considerable attention to the Budapest operation, which the Red Army designated the battle's official title, is Alexei Isaf and Maxim Kolomit's Tomb of the Panzerwaffe, The Defeat of the 6th SS Panzer Army in Hungary 1945, translated and published in 2014 by Helion. A product by two Russian military historians, the book's primary focus is the defeat of Sepp Dietrich's 6th SS Panzer Armee after the failure of his Frühlingserwachsen offensive in March 1945. However, in part one of the book, the authors set the stage for Germany's last offensive on the Eastern Front by describing over the course of the first seven chapters how the relief attempt of Budapest by the 4th SS Panzer Corps and the Red Army's strong reaction to it created the necessary conditions for the much larger battles that were to follow in its wake. Drawing upon numerous contemporary Red Army accounts, including the war diaries of the 3rd Ukrainian Front and that of its artillery commander, the war diary of the 4th Guards Army, and those of three other field armies, the 26th, 27th, and 57th, and finally the war diaries of three separate mechanized corps, 18th and 23rd Tank Corps, and the 1st Guards Mechanized Corps, all of which played key roles in defeating Unternehmen Konrad 1-3, this should be a mandatory reference work for anyone attempting to understand the battle. Though it is written from the perspective of the Red Army, it is even-handed and free of communist-era jargon and is noteworthy for its cold-blooded evaluation of the results of the various engagements between January and March 1945, as well as lessons learned to be applied during future conflicts. Lastly, the translation of the Red Army's General Staff Study written during the final phase of the war in Hungary is included in the Budapest Operation 1945, an operational strategic study, published in 2017 by Helion and Company, now available in English. This 1945 dated study, number 21 in the Red Army's Sobornik Materialov po Izuchenio Obdjavonyi series, collection of materials on the study of war experience, is a critical, relatively unvarnished account that is often at odds with the official story presented by the propaganda organs of the former Soviet Union. It also includes a 1957 internal publication issued by the Red Army's General Staff Academy, the 3rd Ukrainian Front's operation in the Budapest Operation, written by Major General S.P. Tarasov, which details the efforts by that army group to block the three German relief attempts of Budapest, especially the fighting to stop Gille's 4th SS Panzer Corps. While the Sobornik, describing the operations to liberate Warsaw between July and November 1944, has yet to be published, this recently published translation of the Red Army's account of its Budapest operation proved to be a boon to the author, providing an insider's view of the internal workings of large-scale Soviet formations, whose armies, corps, and divisions proved to be the 4th SS Panzer Corps' last major and most formidable adversaries. Taken together, these sources provide sufficient details and information to reconstruct the operations of Gille's corps during the last months of the war, beginning with the relatively inactive month of December 1944, then its rapid transfer to Hungary, its participation in the relief attempts of Budapest, positional warfare east of Lake Balaton, its role in the last major German offensive of the war, Unternehmen Frühlingserwachsen, and the various delaying actions it fought during the last 2 months of the war as the 4th SS Panzer Corps and other German formations fruitlessly attempted to block the Red Army's entry into Vienna and beyond. In this volume, Hungarian names of towns, villages, and terrain features are used as much as possible, though German names for major Hungarian cities are used unless otherwise noted, such as Rab, Győr, Gran, Hron, and Komorn, Komárom. English names for major lakes and rivers are also used as appropriate, such as the Danube and Gran rivers and lakes Balaton and Valença. The reasoning behind this decision is that German armed forces during World War II almost exclusively referred to locations using updated versions of Austro-Hungarian maps, which used German-language place names, except for instances when the German and Hungarian place names were identical. In some cases, after each initial use of the German place name, the modern Hungarian equivalent immediately follow, so that anyone using current maps to trace the course of the fighting should have no difficulty in locating the same locations today using online tools such as Google Maps. While many of those who provided assistance in the drafting of the first volume have already been mentioned, several additional historians who have helped exclusively with this volume also deserve to be recognized. First, I would like to thank Perry Pyrrhic of the Netherlands, who generously shared a copy of Manfred Schönfelder's detailed monograph about the 4th SS Panzer Corps' role in the relief of Budapest. The original document, which at one point was in the Viking Division's Truppenkameradschaft, Veterans Association archives, has since been lost. I would also like to thank Norbert Schamweber of Hungary for his help, as well as that provided by U.S. Army Colonel retired French McLean and Lieutenant Colonel retired Mark Reardon. I would also like to thank Charles Trang of France and Mirko Beirel of Norway for their generous help in providing photographs depicting the combat operations of Gille's Corps during the closing days of the war. Mr. Beirel, probably the world's most knowledgeable expert on the course of the three Budapest relief operations, was especially helpful in freely sharing additional material he has collected during his research into the operations of the Viking Division in Hungary over the past 30 years. Among other items he has shared with the author, including the personal diaries of participants such as Manfred Schönfelder, Gunther Janke, Willy Hein, and Manfred Renz, he also shared additional maps and original documents. He has also walked the ground several times where many of the key actions occurred while leading staff rides of the battlefield for foreign military historians. Through Mr. Beirel, the author was introduced to Viktor Uchov, a resident of Rostov, Russia, who translated a number of captured German documents, including operations orders and communications of the 4th SS Panzer Corps, that have never before been translated into English. I would like to once again thank Oberstleutnant der Bundeswehr retired Gunther Lange, former Begleitsoffizier, aide-de-camp of General Gille, for his continuing advice and encouragement. He has also been extremely gracious in sharing the contents of his considerable archive with me, without which there would have been many gaps in my narrative. Throughout this process, he has been extremely kind and patient with my many requests for information and clarification in regards to original documents as well as photographs. Along with the help of his son Wolfgang Lange, who conducted all of the translation and served as a go-between for his father and I, his assistance has been simply invaluable. I also want to express my thanks once again to those stalwarts who have been behind me all the way in this process, including the crew from Casemate Publishers, especially David Farnsworth, Ruth Shepard, Daniela Lipscomb, Isabel Fulton, Tony Walton, and Felicity Goldsack. In addition, I would like to mention the continuing assistance of Herbert Ackermans, Tom Albright, Christian Ankerstjerne, Christoph Avende, Predag Blanusa, Martin Block, Geir Brendan, Prit Butar, Carol Byrne, Andrew Found, Tim Hassler, Justin Horgan, my mapmaker Tom Houlihan, Petter Jellender, John Moore, Tommy Natadal, Kamen Nevenkin, Roland Pfeiffer, Mark Rickmanspool, Remy Spezzano of RZM Publishing, Bram von Strahlen, Victor Uchoff, Jan-Hendrik Vermeulen, Hans Weber, Lennart Westberg, Lars Westerlund, Ian Michael Wood, David O'Keefe, and Jess T. Lukens. My thanks to you all. Lastly, I would like to thank my wife, Jill, for her support and encouragement throughout this 5-year process. The many days and hours spent downstairs in my bunker while working on this manuscript meant that we both had to forego several vacations, weekend getaways, and other activities that we normally pursued, all sacrificed in the course of this project. Throughout the past several years, including recent months of isolation while the coronavirus raged unabated, she has been my rock and guiding star, always there for me, and with a ready cup of coffee or a glass of wine when I needed it. I would never have finished this without her. I owe you big time, Jilly. Douglas E. Nash, Sr., Washington, D.C., June 2020. Chapter 1. The Lost Month, 27 November to 27 December 1944. Despite their numerous and occasionally heated disagreements over tactics and Soviet intentions, General der Panzertruppen von Lüttwitz and Obergruppenführer Gille parted on good terms. The 9th Armee commander greatly appreciated the contribution that 4th SS Panzer Corps had made to the successful defense of Warsaw and was genuinely sorry to see Gille and his men leave. In recognition of their accomplishments and sacrifices, von Luttwitz issued the following proclamation upon their departure. To the 4th SS Panzer Corps, as of 26 November 1944, after nearly 4 months of service, you will no longer be under the command authority of the 9th Armee. With pride and satisfaction, the 9th Armee looks back upon this period in which the 4th SS Panzer Corps, under the tried and true leadership of your commanding general, Obergruppenführer und General der Waffen-SS Gille, has once again attached immortal glory to your banners. In an exemplary display of comradeship, the SS divisions under his command, along with the divisions of the German and Hungarian armies, repeatedly broke the onslaught of a greatly superior enemy force in 3 bloody defensive battles east and north of Warsaw. The 3rd SS Panzer Division Totenkopf and the 5th SS Panzer Division Wiking both contributed significantly to these considerable successes. I would like to express my appreciation and thanks for their magnificent feat of arms and extend to the 4th SS Panzer Corps heartfelt wishes for the future. Our fight goes on until the final victory. Long live the Führer. By the end of November 1944, the 4th SS Panzer Corps had been fighting along the Vistula Hauptkampflinie, main line of battle or front line, for 4 months. Although it had lost much ground during that period, and its divisions had suffered the loss of thousands of their men, the Corps had prevented a major breakthrough by the 1st Belorussian Front and had inflicted an enormous number of casualties upon the Soviet and Polish forces, as well as destroying hundreds of tanks. Having withdrawn to the Fuchsstellung, Fox defensive position, in the wedge of land formed by the Narew River in the north and the Vistula River in the southwest, in the area nicknamed the Wet Triangle by the troops, the Corps had been engaged in siege warfare since 28 October 1944. There are few records remaining from this lost period in the Corps' history, but using a variety of sources, an outline is presented here for the first time. Though no major actions had taken place throughout November and December, the troops of Obergruppenführer Gille's Corps had endured daily bombardment by Soviet artillery and air attacks by the Red Air Force's 16th Air Army. Daily patrolling, sniper duels, repair of fighting positions, and enduring night raids by the opposing force had filled the days and nights of the men from the Totenkopf and Wiking divisions. Fortunately, the width of the front lines in this sector was so narrow that it could be held by just 2 regiments abreast, allowing each division to frequently rotate troops in and out of the line and grant them some rest, as well as to dedicate time towards training the thousands of new replacements each division had received during the past month. By early December, only 1 regiment with 3 battalions was sufficient to hold this portion of the front, a testimony to the strength of the fortifications constructed during October and November. North of the Narew, the Corps defended a narrow strip of land less than 20 kilometers wide with 1 tank battalion from SS Panzerregiment 5 and the Germania Regiment with several attached Heeres battalions. Positioned on its left flank was the 542nd Grenadier Division, officially renamed as a Volksgrenadier Division, or VGD, on 9 October 1944, of the neighboring 20th Armee Corps. Until 26 November, 4th SS Panzer Corps had been serving under General der Panzertruppen von Luttwitz's 9th Armee, but when that army was detached and transferred to the control of Heeresgruppe A on that date, Obergruppenführer Gille's Corps remained in place but came under the command of Generaloberst Weiss's 2nd Armee of Heeresgruppe Mitte. However, which field army Gille's Corps was subordinated to made little difference in the overall scheme of things until the situation in Hungary began to deteriorate markedly in mid-December. By this point, most of the decisive fighting had shifted elsewhere, leaving the 4th SS Panzer Corps serving in a tactical backwater until the end of the month. Casualties within the Corps' 2 divisions were correspondingly low, while those suffered by Korpstruppen were practically nil. By the end of December 1944, the Totenkopf had suffered the loss of only 10 soldiers wounded in action and no deaths. The Viking had lost 6 men killed, 35 wounded and 2 missing. A total of 53 men in all for both divisions, a far cry from the astronomical losses both suffered between August and October 1944. In December, the number of men reported as sick, 120 and 194 respectively, for the first time outnumbered the killed, wounded, and missing. In comparison, during the same period, the 542nd Volksgrenadier Division, which joined the Corps on 28 November, suffered 518 casualties in December, an indication of the width of its sector and the aggressiveness of enemy troops opposing it. The only officer killed in action throughout December was Untersturmführer Karl Östwich, a Norwegian platoon leader in the newly arrived 1st Bataillon Norge, who was killed in a Soviet night raid east of Modlin on 25 December. The troops themselves seemingly did not mind the quiet front, since they had fought without a break for nearly 4 months, and both divisions had passed the point of exhaustion. Not only had each division suffered thousands of casualties and had to absorb an equal number of new replacements into their ranks, but their weapons, vehicles, and equipment were worn out and needed replacement or significant servicing in order to become fully combat ready again. There were shortages of some weapons, especially light machine guns and machine pistols, but in the main, the troops had nearly a full complement of infantry weapons. Though new troops, most only recently transferred from the Luftwaffe, guns and vehicles had begun flowing into their shattered regiments, one item was not being replaced: the primary symbol of the Panzer Division, their tanks. Due to the higher priority assigned to re-equipping the Panzer Divisions on the Western Front, scheduled to take part in the upcoming Wacht am Rhein, Operation Watch on the Rhine counteroffensive in the Ardennes, the Eastern Front received only half the number of replacement armored vehicles that the Western Front did, despite the looming threat posed by the resurgent Red Army. There were also nearly three times as many divisions fighting in the East as there were in the West, so the number of tanks that the Ostheer did receive were far less than what was required to replace those that had been lost in fighting that summer. Hitler, as he was wont to do, had assumed that once he had finished with the Western Allies in the Ardennes, he could simply redirect his forces to the Eastern Front, where they would quickly finish off Stalin's forces. A gross and irresponsible miscalculation, to say the least. What this meant for the Panzer regiments of the Totenkopf and Wiking divisions was that they would have to make the best of the few tanks they had left. The Totenkopf Division's SS-Panzerregiment III had received its last 4 Panzer V Panthers on 27 July 1944, and its last 17 Panzer IVs on 9 August 1944. The division would have to wait until 3 May 1945, less than a week before the war ended, before it would receive any more. The case was similar with the Viking Division's SS-Panzerregiment V. It had received its last 8 Panthers on 23 April 1944, and its last 17 Panzer IVs on 26 September, of which nearly half were lost in a single day, less than 3 weeks later in the fighting at Nieporet, during the Third Defensive Battle of Warsaw. Each of its remaining Panthers had amassed well over 1,000 kilometers on their odometers since their first operation during the relief of Kovel at the end of March 1944, and were displaying their hard usage in the form of worn-out tracks, engines, transmissions, and final drives. The Viking Division would also receive no more replacement tanks until 8 April 1945. When 7 Jagdpanzer Vs and 1 Panzer V Bergepanzer recovery vehicle were issued to Kampfgruppe Viking fighting near Hanover on the Western Front, far from the rest of the division. The net effect of this policy, of course, was to ensure that 2 of the Waffen-SS's most experienced panzer divisions soon became armored divisions in name only, with the Totenkopf and Viking divisions having 68 and 40 tanks respectively, only a battalion's equivalent, or less than a battalion in the case of SS-Panzerregiment V. The situation was only slightly better regarding assault guns and tank destroyers, with the Totenkopf Division having 52 and the Viking Division just 18. At their authorized strength, The Corps' two divisions would normally have had a combined total of 475 tanks, assault guns, and tank destroyers, but by the end of November 1944, they had only 178 on hand, roughly 37%, and not all of these were operational. Since neither division would receive any replacement vehicles in significant numbers before the war ended, the role of each Panzer Regiment's maintenance company became even more important. At least in regards to their authorized number of Schützenpanzerwagen, SPW, to ferry their Panzer Grenadiers to battle, the Viking Division was relatively well off, with 227 of the Sonderkampffahrzeug, 250 and 251 SPWs on hand, out of 308 authorized, while the Totenkopf was not, having only 88 on hand, not all being operational. Thus, while the Viking Division had more tactical mobility, the Totenkopf had more armored fighting vehicles, a factor that would later influence how each division was employed in future operations. With no new tank deliveries to count on, each of the remaining vehicles had to be kept at the highest state of readiness possible by their crews and maintenance personnel in order to provide the commanders with the greatest number of tanks for battle at any given time. Even recovery of badly damaged tanks assumed greater importance, for these, even if destroyed, could provide a wealth of spare parts to keep the remaining ones running. In a situation like this, the few Bergepanzer each regiment possessed assumed an importance out of all proportion to their number. The number of operational tanks during December would not noticeably increase, which meant that the Corps' two panzer divisions would go into battle with the same low number of tanks they had a month earlier, despite the best efforts of everyone involved at the Corps headquarters level and below. Ironically, the crews to operate a full issue of new vehicles were available, but when new tanks did not arrive, both divisions were forced to form their own ad hoc units to prevent them from being used as infantry replacements. The Viking Division established a two-company Lehrabteilung, training battalion, of approximately 200 men in late November 1944 with these men, and had them transferred from the front lines to the SS training area in Schieratz, before being finally shipped to the Zennerlager tank training area in February 1945. The Totenkopf collected its excess tank crews, some 210 men, in a Sammelkommando, or collection unit, on 31 January 1945 at Veszprém, Hungary, and shipped them on 15 February 1945 to Zennerlager II. Here, both units waited in vain until the war's end for the tanks which they so eagerly sought. When these men were used to form the SS Panzerverband Westfalen on 29 March, or SS Kampfgruppe Viking 4 days later, the war was practically over. Their experiences were typical. With tank production already failing to keep pace with tank losses on all fronts as early as July 1944, resupplying the 4th SS Panzer Corps with replacement panzers after September 1944 simply was not a priority. This situation prevailed until the end of the war. But in all fairness, by early 1944, Adolf Hitler personally set the monthly priorities for tank production and allocation based on his own unrealistic strategy for winning the war, not the priorities of the OKW or the OKH, which normally would have fulfilled that role. Though the situation concerning the number of armored fighting vehicles was worsening, as far as unit Iststärke, actual unit strength, was concerned, the situation was improving. However, incorporating the thousands of Luftwaffe replacements into the ranks of the Panzer Grenadier regiments had been problematic, for a number of reasons, all of which were recounted in the previous volume. The greatest personnel challenge that remained was preparing the former Luftwaffe NCOs, who had been assigned to fulfill their new roles as leaders at the infantry squad and platoon level. These men, though well-intentioned, simply lacked the experience and tactical savvy needed to lead troops in ground combat, and 2 or 3 weeks of classroom instruction at the division's Feldersatzbataillone could not compensate for this. Nevertheless, on paper at least, all four SS Panzergrenadier regiments looked healthy and were gaining in strength with each passing day. The corps commander knew the true situation, of course, as did his two division commanders. How these replacement junior leaders would perform in a major battle had yet to be seen. But Gille, Helmut Becker, commander of the Totenkopf division, and Karl Ulrich, Viking division commander, were not optimistic. The junior Luftwaffe enlisted men had performed well during the past month, though they had suffered very high casualties when introduced to battle due to their inexperience. But at least they were more amenable to life as an infantryman compared to their NCOs. They were also more motivated and imbued with a National Socialist Weltanschauung, or political worldview, having been raised since children in an atmosphere where loyalty to the Führer was all they had ever known. An unexpected improvement in the overall combat strength of the Viking division occurred on 17 November 1944, when the 1st Bataillon SS-Panzergrenadier Regiment 23 Norge, commanded by Sturmbannführer Fritz Vogt, and 1st Bataillon SS-Panzergrenadier Regiment 24 Denmark, commanded by Sturmbannführer Hermann im Mascha, were assigned. Both arrived via rail at the division's reception point at Modlin train station that same day, and were immediately sent to the front lines that evening. Both were nominally part of the 11th SS Panzergrenadier Division Nordland, and had been undergoing reconstitution at the Hammerstein SS training area in Pomerania, modern-day Czarna, since September 1944, after being nearly destroyed during the Battle of Narva the previous January. Due to Gille's urgent request for more troops at the end of the Third Defensive Battle of Warsaw, Obergruppenführer Ernst Jüttner at the SS-FHA, main SS leadership office in Berlin, belatedly decided to do what he could to alleviate the problem, and on 16 November directed that both of these battalions be temporarily attached to the Viking division instead of being sent back to their parent division, which in any case was cut off and isolated in the Courland Peninsula by this point. Rather than being assigned to either the Germania or Westland regiments, they would instead operate either independently under division control or by temporary attachment to either regiment. Though neither of them were manned at their authorized full strength, both still had approximately 600 men assigned, serving under the command of experienced SS officers and NCOs. Most of their rank and file were young German conscripts from Austria or Volksdeutsche from southeastern Europe, while approximately 40 Norwegian officers and NCOs were still with Vogt's battalion. Few, if any, Luftwaffe transferees were counted among the ranks of either battalion, which still had a number of veteran Waffen-SS officers and NCOs, which might explain the high fighting efficiency that both battalions would later display. Upon arrival at the front, both Sturmbannführer Vogt and Sturmbannführer im Mascha's battalions were placed under the tactical control of Obersturmbannführer Franz Hack's Westland Regiment, which allowed him to move his 2nd and 3rd Bataillone into a reserve position behind the lines for a well-earned rest. Sturmbannführer Vogt's 1st Bataillon Norge went into the line adjacent to 3rd Bataillon Totenkopf sector in the Wet Triangle, with Sturmbannführer im Mascha's 1st Bataillon Denmark arrayed in the center. Holding the Westland's left flank along the Narev, adjacent to the 542nd Volksgrenadier Division, was the regiment's 1st Bataillon under Sturmbannführer Nederhof. The arrival of the two new battalions was not officially reported to 2nd Armee until 27 November, when the 4th SS Panzerkorps' Quartiermeister had to report both of them separately as part of its personnel strength in order to draw their allotment of rations. Many of the troops from the two battalions of the Nordland Division who arrived during this period found life in the trenches hard, especially compared to the relative comfort of the troop training areas they had just left. One soldier from 1st Bataillon Norge, Norwegian SS volunteer Jan Barstein, wrote after the war that in November 1944, a few days after their battalion arrived in the Modlin area, we were assigned to rifle pits, located in a flat sandy area. A few holes in the ground served as our living quarters, which were hardly worthy of being called a bunker. A narrow ditch led from the front line trench to our shelter. In each of these holes lived five of us, which would accommodate us if we all lay down on the same side at the same time. It was about 80 to 100 meters away from the Russian trenches. No man's land was mostly potato fields, with a little barbed wire and landmines. We had no oven, and every second evening we received a so-called Hindenburg candle that would give us light for about three-quarters of an hour. It was a black, cold winter. There was little to eat, and what we got, we had to eat in the dark, and the food was usually frozen and full of sand when it arrived. It was 2 kilometers from our trenches to where rations had to be picked up. The worst thing about it was that we never got enough water, and what we received along with our rations we drank right away. We were always thirsty. Though combat activity throughout December 1944 continued at a relatively low level, this did not mean that the troops of 4th SS Panzer Corps remained idle. Far from it, in fact. Several units developed inventive schemes designed to keep their opponents occupied and to deceive them as to their actual strength and real location. For example, 1st Abteilung SS Panzerregiment 5 had been engaged in constructing dummy tanks of wood and scrap metal since 13 November to attract Soviet artillery fire along their security line north of the Narev River. Periodically, they would take them apart and erect them elsewhere, where they would soon attract the attention of their opponents' forward observers. To enhance their realism, on at least one occasion, troops from the battalion engaged in this effort erected their dummy tanks near gun positions of one of the Germania regiment's anti-tank platoons. Whenever the guns fired, the Soviets, mistaking them for actual panzers, would respond by placing a mortar barrage on their location. On another occasion, one of these dummy tanks was destroyed by artillery fire, thus accomplishing their purpose. The weather during this last period of relative inactivity continued to worsen, and it became bitingly cold. The wind whipped the heavy snowfall into knee-high drifts, which obscured minefields and other obstacles in no man's land. Commanders scaled back infantry patrols due to the danger of them being detected against the white background, whether they were carried out in the day or night. Rainwater seeped into fighting positions and froze. It was everything that troops in exposed forward positions could do to keep themselves from freezing to death, necessitating the frequent rotation of men in observation posts in front of the main defense line. Life continued underground as the men took advantage of the well-constructed fighting positions erected by German, Polish, and Hungarian labor battalions during October. Small stoves provided some warmth, and tiny Hindenburg lamps provided sufficient light to write letters by once the sun set. Quiet moments were occasionally interrupted by a stray enemy shell or machine gun fire. While it was a miserable existence, the few remaining Eastern Front veterans from Totenkopf and Wiking divisions had seen far worse. To everyone, it must have seemed that this phase of the war would last forever. Throughout this period, the normal arrival and departure of units from the Corps' order of battle continued. On 26 November, Schwere Heeresartillerieabteilung 154 returned to 9th Armee control, followed the next day by the departure of Stellungswerfer Regiment 103 with its 18-15cm Nebelwerfer 41 and 15-30cm Nebelwerfer 42 rocket launchers, whose firepower would be sorely missed. On 28 November, the 542nd Volksgrenadier Division, along with Festungsinfanterie Bataillon 1405, joined the Corps when Obergruppenführer Gille's northern boundary was extended farther to the north, taking over another portion of the front formerly held by Generalleutnant von Rohmann's 20th Armee Corps. At some point after 1 December, von Rohmann's Corps headquarters had been castled or transferred to the northernmost sector of the 2nd Armee Front, with its former portion of the front line divided between the 4th SS Panzer Corps and the 27th Armee Corps. Also on 1 December, the sector defended by the Germania Regiment north of the Narev was taken over by Grenadier Regiment 1077 of the 542nd Volksgrenadier Division, thereby allowing Obersturmbannführer Hans Dorr's regiment to go into Corps reserve. The only exception was Hauptsturmführer Pleiner's 2nd Bataillon, whose four companies remained behind. It was ordered to remain in its current position where it was responsible for defending the northern bank of the Narev from the eastern outskirts of Dambe, as far west as the village of Orzechowo, until it was finally relieved on the night of 5 to 6 December by Fusilier Bataillon 542. At the same time, Landeschützen Bataillon 998, which had been attached to the Germania Regiment, was relieved and sent back to the 9th Armee. This shift finally meant that the only Waffen-SS troops actually fighting in the Wet Triangle were from the Westland Regiment of the Viking Division, with three battalions engaged, including Sturmbannführer Vogts, in the arc stretching from the Narev southwest to the Vistula. The Germania Regiment, except for one battalion, the 2nd Battalion, was finally granted the opportunity to reform its ranks in the remaining time available when it was pulled out of the line and designated as part of the 4th SS Panzer Corps Reserve. A major development occurred the following day, when the Totenkopf Division was designated as the 2nd Armee Armored Reserve, which would mark the first time since June 1944 that Brigadeführer Becker's division had not been in combat. Pursuant to this order, its companies, battalions, and regiments began pulling out of the front lines on 3 December and started moving into their new positions encompassing the area straddling the large towns of Nasilsk and Plönen, modern-day Punsk. The only element of the division still positioned in the Wet Triangle, 3rd Bataillon SS Panzer Grenadier Regiment 5 Totenkopf, was relieved in the lines by Sturmbannführer Vogts' newly arrived 1st Bataillon Norge, which extended its lines to the south. The only other unit of the division exempt from this order was 1st Abteilung SS Panzer Regiment 3, which was ordered to stay behind in Modlin as the 4th SS Panzer Corps Armored Reserve with its 26 remaining Panzer V Panthers. The Totenkopf Division's new Gefechtsstand, or command post, was located in the town of Volka, northeast of Novi Miasto, while its 1B Adjutantur moved into its new location at Kuchary Żydowski. Although the division was now directly subordinate to Headquarters 2nd Armee, it would remain under the administrative jurisdiction of the 4th SS Panzer Corps. Despite the fact that Obergruppenführer Gille had temporarily lost control of one of his panzer divisions, he still commanded the Overstrength Viking Division, as well as the 542nd Volksgrenadier Division, should the Soviets show any inclination towards resuming their offensive. In addition, Becker and his troops were not far away in case of an emergency, being located on average merely 30 kilometers away from Modlin. At first, the Totenköpfle, the nickname the troops called themselves, were disappointed in their new living areas, which in many cases were simply empty buildings or private homes whose Polish inhabitants had been forcefully evacuated. According to the commander of 11th Company of the Totenkopf Regiment, whose troops were billeted in the rural village of Katne, "Our new quarters were rather primitive, a cottage and two barns for the entire company. Most of these structures were without electricity, heat, or fuel, but troops soon got to work to improve them any way they could to make them as habitable as possible for what promised to be a long, cold winter." The Totenkopf Division's leaders would not let this precious reprieve go to waste. Besides the important need to service and maintain equipment, the division finally had an unfettered opportunity to institute a rigorous training program aimed at instilling in its thousands of new recruits the motivation and dedication for which its SS spirit had become famous. Training, weather permitting, would be conducted at the individual and collective level, ranging from squad to platoon, then from company to battalion, and finally from regimental to division level. When they were not training, its men would be engaged in conducting rear area security duties, ever alert against the significant threat posed by Polish partisans. Whenever possible, soldiers who had not had the opportunity for a two-week Heimaturlaub, home leave, would be given a chance to go home and visit loved ones while there was still time. Awards were bestowed upon deserving soldiers, such as Sturmbannführer Gerhard Pellen of SS Panzer Aufklärung Abteilung 3, awarded the German Cross in gold on 7 December. Unterscharführer Alfred Tischkus of the same battalion, who received the Knight's Cross on 11 December, and Hauptscharführer Helmut Büch, who was presented with that most rare of awards, the Nahkampfspange im Gold, close combat badge in gold, on 12 December. The latter decoration was only awarded to those who had engaged in 50 days of hand-to-hand or close-in combat with the enemy. Few lived long enough to receive this official recognition of their skill and luck as a frontline soldier, and those who wore it were afforded tremendous respect from their peers. Once he recovered from the wound he received during his most recent action, Büch would be granted a special 21-day home leave. The rotation of units in and out of the 4th SS Panzer Corps continued apace. On the same day that the Totenkopf Division began moving to its reserve position, the 2nd Azerbaijani Battalion of Sonderverband Bergmann, one of several foreign legions responsible for rear area security in the 2nd Armee Korruk, departed. 2 days later, in relation to the shift of the 20th Armee Corps, Obergruppenführer Gille assumed responsibility for most of its entire former defensive sector on 5 December. With this development, his corps now assumed command and control of both the 35th and 252nd Infantry Division, adding to his own 20-kilometer-long defensive line another 30 kilometers, extending it from the area west of Serotsk as far north as Pultusk. On that same date, Luftwaffe Flakregiment 77 and Werfer-Brigade 1 were added to the 4th SS Panzer Corps' lineup. For the first time in the 4th SS Panzer Corps' history, soldiers from the Wehrmacht outnumbered those of the Waffen-SS within its ranks. On 6 December, the lack of Corps heavy artillery assets was partially made up by the attachment of 2nd Abteilung Schwere Heeresartillerie-Regiment 69, motorisiert, by 2nd Armee. The Corps' designated heavy artillery battalion, Schweres SS-Artillerie-Abteilung 504, was still undergoing its necessary instruction period at the Benešov training area in Bohemia and Moravia and would not be ready for another 2 months. Until then, Wehrmacht artillery units would have to fulfill that role. As an indication of the overall low level of combat activity along the Vistula and Narev defense lines in December, ammunition expenditures were minimal throughout this period, with only 15 to 20 tons of artillery, mortar, and small arms munitions being fired on an average day. Incidentally, the Stab and 2nd Abteilung Schweres Heeres Artillerie Regiment 69 motorisiert was the last unit of any significance to join the Corps' order of battle during December, so that by Christmas Eve, the 4th SS Panzer Corps consisted of the Viking Division, the 35th and 252nd Infanterie Division, and the 542nd Volksgrenadier Division, as well as the aforementioned Corps troops, roughly 65,000 men in all. On 7 December, Festungsinfanterie Bataillon 1405 departed the Corps' order of battle for the third and final time, being pulled out to serve as part of the Army Group's reserve. Besides witnessing the coming and going of units within the framework of Obergruppenführer Gille's Corps, a number of other incidents filled the calendar from the end of November and throughout December 1944. For instance, on 28 November, Hitler issued a directive that granted authority to subordinate leaders to take command should their leaders not display the proper willingness to fight. It stated, "I therefore command, if a troop leader who on his own believes that he must give up the fight, he must first ask his officers, then NCOs, then the troops, if one of them wants to fulfill the mission and continue the fight. If this is the case, he must hand over the command, regardless of the rank, and subordinate himself to his junior. The new leader takes over the command with all decision-making authority and duties." This order was promulgated by the OKW to address Hitler's belief that Wehrmacht leaders at all levels were displaying insufficient enthusiasm for continuing the war, even defeatism, as well as the lack of dedicated leadership needed to continue fighting at the tactical level. Der Führer felt that this tendency manifested itself in a lack of aggressiveness and indecisiveness that often resulted in the enemy seizing the advantage and turning the tables on German troops. As of yet, this was not a problem within the ranks of the Waffen-SS, its leaders having been inculcated in the proper National Socialist outlook since the earliest days of its founding. On 1 December 1944, in recognition of its conduct during the Battle of Modlin, Himmler issued an order praising the 4th SS Panzer Corps and its subordinate units. The performance of the 4th SS Panzer Corps under the leadership of SS Obergruppenführer Gille with subordinate 3rd SS Panzer Division Totenkopf and 5th SS Panzer Division Wiking during the fighting northeast of Warsaw in the month of November 1944 was characterized by special bravery and steadfastness. While such praise was appreciated by the Corps' members, what they really needed was more tanks to replace those they had lost since the end of July, not empty, though well-meaning, phrases. On 3 December, because of the near-daily loss through capture of German frontline soldiers in their fighting positions by Soviet night patrols, Obergruppenführer Gille issued a corps order that threatened severe punishment to any officers or NCOs who, through their own negligence or lack of fighting spirit, made their particular sector of the front line vulnerable to nightly forays by the enemy. This order was issued due to two night raids carried out in the sector defended by the 542nd Volksgrenadier Division during the past 2 days, resulting in the loss of several men taken prisoner. In both cases, neither infantry company involved had a response force readily available to conduct a counterattack to regain the prisoners, prompting investigations by the division's commander, Generalleutnant Karl Löwrich. The 4th SS Panzer Corps' commander required that all individuals involved in each incident be interrogated to determine the cause and to apportion blame. Gille directed his ire towards one of his own SS units, since one of the cases involved the capture of a soldier from 6th Company of the Germania Regiment, commanded by Untersturmführer Hans-Jürgen Koch. These cases were not isolated incidents. As an antidote to what Generaloberst Weiss saw as an increasingly lax attitude developing among the frontline troops of 2nd Armee, on 5 December, he ordered that a series of alarm exercises be planned and carried out by all of his army's corps. Consequently, that same day, Obergruppenführer Gille ordered both the Viking and 542nd Volksgrenadier Divisions to plan and carry out these readiness drills in their respective rear areas, set to commence 3 days later. The order specified that units were to regularly train their men to carry out counterattacks by night as well as by day, to rehearse movement to alternate defensive positions, and to coordinate their actions on a regular basis with adjacent units in order to improve cross-boundary communications. In addition, all units concerned were ordered to improve their local communications network that had been set up to warn of tank attacks and to prepare demolition charges for bridges, anti-tank ditches, and key fortifications in their defensive sectors. Obergruppenführer Gille himself, or his chief of staff, would personally observe these readiness drills. On 7 December, the 4th SS Panzer Corps 1B, Quartiermeister and Adjutantur relocated from the Smoshevo Palace to Plönen, though Gille and his Gefechtstand remained in Modlin. The following day, the Totenkopf Divisions 1B and 4A, the personnel and administrative offices, relocated to Sochochin, 5 kilometers northeast of the Corps' Quartiermeister. In regards to personnel, during this period, men who had been wounded returned from convalescent leave to rejoin their old companies, but not all of them. Some were permanently disabled, fit only for light duties back in the homeland, such as guarding concentration camps or working as a clerk in an office at the SSFHA. Not all recovered from their wounds. On 13 December, Obersturmführer Wilhelm Warnke, commander of 11th Company of 3rd Gepäck Germania, died at a Reserve Lazarett hospital in Sagen from a lingering infection after being severely wounded in action by artillery fragments on 13 August while leading his company in a counterattack to regain ground lost near Grabow during Unternehmen Brückenschlag. He had taken command of the company the previous May and had led his SPW-mounted company with skill and bravery during the bloody summer east of Warsaw. Another noteworthy event was the rotation of the entire artillery regiment of the Viking Division with that of the Totenkopf in mid-December. Battery by battery, the incoming guns and gun crews from SS Panzer Artillery Regiment 3 replaced those of their sister division, while those of SS Panzer Artillery Regiment 5 crossed over the Vistula or Narev and occupied the same winter quarters that the Totenkopf's gunners had just given up. According to one artillery battalion commander of the Viking division, the new positions were well constructed and lay in a forest. Sufficient bunkers were available to suit our needs. For our planned Christmas celebrations, the 2nd Batterie even constructed a large common bunker, big enough to hold everyone. In general, the time passed quietly. Another development worthy of note during this period was the reinforcement of the old Tsarist fort at Dombe, deemed the most critical terrain in the 4th SS Panzer Corps sector. This fort, located adjacent to the town of the same name along the northern bank of the Narev, and defended by Fusilier Bataillon 542, offered commanding views both to the north as well as within the wet triangle to the south. Generalleutnant Löwrich, commander of the 542nd Volksgrenadier Division, rightly pointed out that, should it fall, the Soviets would have excellent observation in the rear area positions of the Viking division as far as the Vistula, as well as that of his own division. Consequently, he offered a plan to Obergruppenführer Gille on 18 December describing what he intended to do to fortify this position and a laundry list of the construction materiel, barbed wire, and mines, 3,100, needed to accomplish this. In addition, 8,400 meters of trenches needed to be constructed or improved to make the position more defensible. To perform this task, since he did not have enough troops of his own, Löwrich requested the assignment of a bow pioneer company of 150 men, or the temporary loan of a company from the Corps' attached Feldstrafgefangenenabteilung 1, Field Punishment Prisoner Battalion. Work was still underway on Fort Dombe at the end of the month when the 4th SS Panzer Corps was transferred. To recognize the achievements both on and off the battlefield of Corps troops as well as attached Heerestruppen, a host of awards were distributed by 4th SS Panzer Corps' headquarters under Gille's signature during the latter half of December. While the Corps' divisions administered their separate programs to recognize their own troops, as previously mentioned, unit commanders working directly under the supervision of the Corps headquarters routinely submitted the names of their own men for approval through the Corps 2A, Sturmbannführer Schulze. Taking advantage of the lull in the fighting to catch up on its paperwork, throughout December, Schulze's office processed 260 awards, including 8 Iron Crosses First Class, EK1, and 83 Iron Crosses Second Class, EK2, for valorous conduct in battle, and 170 War Service Crosses 2nd Class with Swords, Kriegsverdienstkreuz 2. Klasse mit Schwerter, for exceptional performance of duty not involving direct combat. Of course, Gille did not present each decoration in person, which would have been impractical except for the 8 EK1s, but he did sign the remaining awards. Of these, officers assigned to the headquarters of 4th SS Panzer Corps garnered 2 of the EK1s. One of these was awarded to Sturmbannführer Herbert Jankun, the Corps' 1C, while the other went to Hauptsturmführer Heinrich Fockenbreck, who succeeded Hauptsturmführer Werner Westphal as the O1. Fockenbreck had died in the SS hospital in Hohenlichen on 21 November from wounds received the previous month, so his award was posthumous. In addition to these high awards, 22 EK2s and 145 Kriegsverdienstkreuz 2. Klasse mit Schwerter were presented to SS troops. Not surprisingly, SS-Werfer Abteilung 504 received the lion's share of the Iron Crosses, 17, for the bravery its men displayed during the Third Defensive Battle of Warsaw, where the rocket launcher battalion suffered nearly 20% casualties. The remainder of the awards were distributed evenly throughout the rest of the Corps troops, including 5 EK2s for members of SS Nachrichtenabteilung 104. Perhaps the oddest one awarded was an EK2 presented to an aviator, Feldwebel Friedrich Schulze, a Fiesele 156 Storch Stork pilot assigned to the Luftwaffe squadron dedicated to supporting the SS and police 7th Staffelflieger Geschwader zur besonderen Verwendung 7. Although the details are not available, he was most likely engaged in flying the Corps commander and other key leaders to meetings at higher headquarters locations, as well as performing other aerial liaison duties, including flying reconnaissance missions against the Polish partisans during Unternehmen Sternschnuppe the previous October. On a cloudy 21 December 1944, the Viking Division conducted a ceremony within the Modlin Fortress for hundreds of its veteran Führer and Unterführer assembled therein to commemorate the fourth anniversary of the division's founding, featuring rousing speeches by the commander of 4th SS Panzer Corps and the division's incumbent commander, Karl Ulrich. Both Gille and Ulrich verbally traced the division's history from its establishment on 21 December 1940 to its introduction to battle in June 1941, the victorious advances into the Ukraine and the Caucasus Mountains during 1941 and 1942, the freezing winters, the massive battles during the summer of 1943, the withdrawal to the Dnieper, the encirclement and breakout from the Cherkasy Pocket, and its epic relief and defense of Kovel. With strains of Wagner and Beethoven blaring from loudspeakers set up for the occasion, the two men held forth for nearly an hour, as the participants shivered in the icy wind that howled through the ancient fortress. Special recognition was afforded to the few remaining Nordic volunteers in the ranks, men from Denmark, Norway, Sweden, and Finland, whose families back home were hated and being persecuted by their fellow countrymen for the actions of the sons, fathers, and brothers who had embarked on the Great Crusade that began on 22 June 1941. According to one eyewitness, Gille and Ulrich recounted that the division was the first in the attack against the enemy and the last during the retreat. That's how the Viking Division etched its deeds in the bloody history of the campaign in the East. It was a captivating picture. The gloomy Polish fortress, the volunteers assembled in it from practically all European countries, men, scoffed and scorned, who left everything behind for 4 years, placed their young lives on the line, buoyed by a belief in a better future. Had they only known what their immediate future held, these veterans most likely would have concluded differently. But on 21 December 1944, with Hitler's promise of wonder weapons that would end the war in Germany's favor already rolling off the assembly lines, there was still room for hope, despite the gloom hovering over the embattled fortress. The following day, Obergruppenführer Gille issued a Christmas message to the men of 4th SS Panzer Corps, both Wehrmacht and Waffen-SS, which appeared in the 6th issue of the Corps' newsletter, Kämpfe des Führers. In addition to offering the usual holiday greeting and acknowledging this most German of all holidays, he closed by invoking the seriousness of Germany's situation and the important role being performed by their Corps. The defense of our homeland, and thus the defense of Europe, is an important mission that has been assigned to us. By defending our wives and children here in the East, at the same time we are safeguarding the life of generations to come and thus the eternal existence of Europe. The guarantors of our victory in this struggle are our strength, the steadfastness of our hearts, and the invincibility of our weapons. Under the leadership of Adolf Hitler, final victory will be ours. At this point, it was evident that no one, not even Gille, anticipated that the Corps would be celebrating Christmas in anything other than relative peace. True, daily artillery exchanges with the enemy patrolling, repelling Soviet raiding parties, and improving defenses would continue as they had for the past 2 months, but no one was expecting anything out of the ordinary. Many men took advantage of the opportunity to visit their families in Germany, such as Obergruppenführer Gille's Begleitoffizier, Untersturmführer Günther Lange, who had stood by his commander's side since May 1944 until being seconded to SS Panzer Regiment 5 for a 3-month assignment as its O1 on 18 December. He had not seen his fiancée or his family in Hamburg-Altona for nearly 2 years, so he leapt at the chance for a 2-week Kriegsurlaubschein, home leave pass. Commanders at all levels encouraged their men who had not taken home leave to apply for it. However, the backlog was so great that a method of prioritization had to be developed. For example, men who had earned the Panzervernichtungsabzeichen, tank destruction badge, were automatically given home leave, as were those who had earned other prestigious awards. For men not yet eligible for leave, the commander of the Totenkopf division came up with an innovative idea for rewarding and boosting the morale of soldiers whose wives had given birth in their absence by allowing the division's 6th staff officer, acting as its NSFO, to award them a savings account of 3,000 Reichsmarks out of division funds for every newborn child. On 23 December, the 4th SS Panzer Corps headquarters issued an order that echoed an identical one sent by 2nd Armee earlier that day, that directed all of its frontline units to increase their level of security on 24 and 25 December. Fearing a Soviet surprise attack designed to take advantage of the relaxation attendant to the Christmas holiday, the order directed all divisions of the Corps be prepared to deal with local attacks by having units pre-designated to carry out counterattacks standing by in prepared positions. To ensure there were enough troops available for such a contingency, as well as to enable frontline infantrymen to be rotated back to second or third line defensive positions to briefly enjoy a Christmas meal that evening, up to 25% of each division's artillerymen and all of their anti-tank battalions were ordered to organize strong Stoßreserven, assault troop reserves. These units were to report that they were formed up and ready for possible employment by 2 p.m. on 24 December. As the Christmas holiday approached, the troops made every effort to make their bunkers, living areas, and dugouts resemble their Yule Festival, at home as much as they could. Wreaths were crafted and hung on doors and bunker entrances. Weihnachtsbäume, Christmas trees, were cut down and brought forward from the rear area, installed in troop bunkers and living areas, and decorated by the men with bright paper, handmade wooden decorations, and candles for illumination. If a company was lucky enough to have a Spieß, first sergeant, who had good organizing skills, perhaps there would be cakes, cookies, and other delicacies, or maybe a roast piglet, or at least a duck for the traditional Christmas Eve feast. Some lucky few received gift parcels from home, which might contain sausage, cheese, and perhaps Oma's, grandmother's, Käsekuchen, or cheesecake, despite severe food rationing at home. Wine and other alcoholic beverages such as homemade schnapps or slivovitz to enliven the festivities were shipped from Germany or procured from local farmers, eager to sell some of their precious liquor to earn enough money to feed their families. For this Christmas, the war's 6th, much of Europe's material and agricultural wealth had been exhausted, and shortages of certain foodstuffs, such as beef or pork, were commonplace. Still, the soldiers of the 4th SS Panzer Corps would try their utmost to create a sense of normalcy and enjoy the holiday, if only for a short time. Perhaps someone would have a radio to listen to the Soldatensende, German Armed Forces radio, or, if they had a gramophone, the latest hit songs from home, such as Es geht alles vorüber, es geht alles vorbei, There's an End to It All, sung by German songbird Lala Anderson. The lyrics were emblematic of the prevailing melancholic mood of the German people as exemplified by the refrain, Everything passes, there's an end to it all. Every December is followed by May. Everything passes, there's an end to it all. But two who love one another always remain faithful. As the holiday approached, Obergruppenführer Gille planned a reception and simple dinner to celebrate Christmas Eve at the fortress in Modlin, inviting all of the Corps staff, division, and regimental commanders from the 5 divisions of the Corps, including the Totenkopf, still enjoying its status as the Heeresgruppe Mitte Reserve. Though each of Gille's subordinate leaders would have made every effort to visit their own men throughout the holiday period, they would have taken pains to observe the normal peacetime courtesies regarding their corps commander's invitation. As Christmas Eve dawned, no major Soviet attack developed despite the intelligence report's warning. During the early morning hours, however, enemy assault troops made several small-scale attempts to penetrate the front lines of the Viking Division and the 542nd Volksgrenadier Division to gather information and take prisoners. Since the Germans had been alerted the day before, none of the Soviet incursions met with success, and their patrols were chased off with artillery or small arms fire. The sounds of tank tracks and engines were also reported by forward outposts, but when nothing happened, the defenders assumed, correctly in this case, that the Soviets were playing recordings of tank noises through loudspeakers as a tactical deception crafted to unnerve the Germans, as they had done before. A heavy ground mist began to form during the late afternoon, obscuring the area beyond the front lines, making observation difficult. Other than this slight disruption, preparations for the Heiligabend, or Christmas Eve celebrations, continued apace. As darkness began to fall, troops began to rotate in shifts between the front lines and rear areas to eat dinner. Troops located further to the rear in reserve positions or in safer tross areas and the various headquarters locations in Modlin and Novi Dvor made their way to whatever shed, barn, or building had been converted, for one night at least, into a makeshift banquet hall. Mess sergeants and troops designated to serve as dining room orderlies began to shuttle food from the goulash kanona, or mobile field kitchen, to the tables. In the fortress at Modlin, the Corps commander's Christmas Eve reception was about to begin. Troops, especially frontline infantrymen and combat engineers who had been living off cold food in the trenches for much of the past month, looked forward to a tasty hot meal with as many of the trimmings that the company Spieß and Feldkoch, or cook, could improvise. Many of the younger soldiers could be forgiven for thinking that perhaps this war was not going so badly. After all, were not German forces in the Ardennes gaining victory after victory over the Anglo-Americans? Had not the Soviet forces in Hungary been smashed by strong German and Hungarian armored counterattacks? Though the Wehrmachtbericht, the daily Wehrmacht communique, and the broadcast by the Soldatensender made it seem as if the tide was finally turning in Germany's favor, the few surviving veterans taking part in the festivities knew how to read between the lines of the news reports and had learned to separate propaganda from truth. As final preparations for the evening were underway, the telephone rang in the Corps command post's Führungsabteilung shortly after 5:05 p.m. It was a call from the 2nd Armee watch officer at Generaloberst Weiss's headquarters. After writing down the details, the 4th SS Panzerkorps tactical group officer on duty that evening, most likely Hauptsturmführer Felder or Oberscharführer Schlemmer, quickly relayed the contents of the message to Obergruppenführer Gille and his chief of staff. After briefly mulling over its import, and probably verifying its authenticity through a telephone conversation with his army commander, or perhaps the SS-FHA in Berlin, Gille ordered that the Totenkopf and Wiking divisions be immediately notified. Gille would inform the commanders of his two SS divisions himself. Less than an hour later, at 6 p.m., the Hellschreiber machines in the Corps command post's Führungsabteilung began to hum with activity. A decoded message from Hitler's Führerhauptquartier, or Führer Headquarters, in Ziegenberg, confirming the warning order and detailing the new mission, began to spool out, to be collected and pasted onto message forms, then carried to the Corps commander for his immediate attention. His own Christmas Eve social gathering in the Modlin Fortress would most likely have been cancelled forthwith. Each SS division received the news in a similar fashion. At approximately 9 p.m. on 24 December, the telephone rang in the Gefechtstand of the Viking Division. The O-1, Obersturmführer Gunther Janke, acting as the watch officer, was handed the phone by the Unteroffizier vom Dienst, or NCO on duty. On the other line was the Corps Chief of Staff, Obersturmbannführer Schönfelder, who asked for the division commander. After informing Schönfelder that Oberführer Ulrich had gone forward to visit the troops in the front lines, Janke was curtly told to stand by. The next moment, Janke was speaking to Obergruppenführer Gille himself. "I hear that Isegrim, code name for Ulrich, isn't there. So listen carefully," said his corps commander, who now had the young lieutenant's full attention. Wir Dorfmühlen zur Julischka. Have you got that? Junker, screwing up his courage to the sticking point, then responded, When, Obergruppenführer? The answer came right away. Immediately. Kampfgruppe Dor this evening, you, that is, division headquarters, tomorrow morning. Then he hung up. As the notification worked its way down through each division's chain of command, units began to become aware that something out of the ordinary was in the air. For instance, just as Sturmbannführer Messele, battalion commander of 4th Abteilung SS Panzer Artillerie Regiment 3, was about to give his Christmas speech to the assembled men of his 10th Batterie that evening, the battalion's runner burst into the barn, which had been converted into a banquet hall for the occasion. Proceeding immediately to his commander, the young soldier handed him a message from regimental headquarters. Upon opening it, Messele read the word Ilmensee, Lake Ilmen, written on the top line. This was the division's standing code for the highest state of alert, meaning that its units were to make themselves ready to march immediately. Every other unit in the division received the same message at roughly the same time. Shortly thereafter, Messele received another message, also an appropriately coded deployment order. Just like the one the Viking division had received, it too emphatically read, Wir Dorfmühlen zur Julischka. Accordingly, Messele gave the appropriate order. The Christmas Eve celebration was quickly forgotten, as the men scrambled to get everything in order, colliding with one another as each hustled about to perform their prearranged task. No one knew where or when they were going, or even if they were going. Messele later recalled, After thinking about it for a moment, then I understood. Dorfmüller is the state minister for transport, whose main role was to operate the railways. Yes, and the Julischka? Then it dawned on me. Railway movement to Hungary. Yet another fire brigade mission. Chapter 2. The Hungarian Theater of Operations, September to 25 December 1944. After receiving the dramatic alert message on Christmas Eve, the troops of 4th SS Panzer Corps quickly began preparing for rail movement to Hungary. While a few fortunate companies and battalions were able to enjoy a curtailed Christmas holiday celebration that had been painstakingly prepared by their unit leadership, most of the Corps' troops were deeply involved in preparing for their new assignment. Over the next several days, thousands of SS men loaded their vehicles and equipment and began boarding troop trains that would transport them to their new area of operations by New Year's Eve. Some of the units had to board trains in the Modlin-Nový Dvor area, still within range of the enemy's guns, and were given a deadly farewell by artillery fire that fell near the rail yards as they departed. According to one member of the Viking, Obersturmführer Gunther Janke, the division's O1, the wet triangle would not be missed. After the war, he wrote, We were glad to be leaving the Modlin fortress. Everyone there feared being surrounded because it was unlikely that we would have ever escaped. Despite the fact that Generaloberst Georg Hans Reinhardt, the commander of Heeresgruppe Mitte, had declared Gille's corps as being essential for the defense of the Vistula Front in light of the Soviet winter offensive expected to occur on or about 12 January 1945, a point of view also echoed by the OKH chief of staff Generaloberst Heinz Guderian, the corps was still sent to what many perceived as being a secondary front. This left many to ask, why Hungary, and why now? In order to understand how this seemingly ill-advised transfer came to pass, and how Obergruppenführer Gille's veteran corps found itself almost immediately involved in heavy sustained combat upon arrival in Hungary, a brief review of the events of the past 3 months is in order. While the several battles for Warsaw fought between 27 July and the end of October 1944 were important events in their own right, they were only part of the vast struggle that raged along the entire Eastern Front in the wake of Operation Bagration. In addition to the tribulations inflicted upon Heeresgruppe Nord and Mitte by the Red Army during this period, Between August and October 1944, a series of cataclysms befell the German forces and their allies arrayed in southeastern Europe. Beginning on 25 August, with the destruction of General der Infanterie Johannes Friesner's Heeresgruppe Südukraine, with its 6th and 8th Armee in Romania at the hands of the 2nd and 3rd Ukrainian Fronts, aided and abetted by the treachery of the Romanian government, the rest of Germany's southeastern front collapsed like a house of cards. Invaded by Colonel General F.I. Tolbukhin's 3rd Ukrainian Front on 8 September, Bulgaria immediately switched sides, thereby opening the door to the Balkans, where 900,000 German occupation troops were fighting various resistance movements at the end of a long and vulnerable supply line, including 300,000 men in Greece alone. While General Feldmarschall GFM Maximilian von Weiches, serving as both Oberbefehlshaber Südost, or Commander-in-Chief Southeast, and Commander of Heeresgruppe F, attempted to simultaneously reconstruct a coherent front line in the wake of Bulgaria's defection and evacuate as many German troops from Greece and Yugoslavia as possible, the main Soviet effort, spearheaded by General of the Army Rodion I. Malinovsky's 2nd Ukrainian Front, quickly closed up on the eastern slopes of the Carpathian mountain range by 5 September, the last natural barrier to the Pushta, the wide-open plains of eastern Hungary. At the same time as Tolbukhin's front was busily engaged in chasing von Weiches' forces out of southern Romania, Bulgaria, and northeastern Yugoslavia after several weeks of fighting for the critically important mountain passes in the Carpathians, Malinovsky's forces were able to force their way through and enter the Hungarian plain between Oradea and Arad by 5 October. By this point, Friesner's Heeresgruppe Südukraine, renamed Heeresgruppe Süd on 23 September, cobbled together from the remnants of 6th and 8th Armee and bolstered by a mishmash of German and Hungarian units of varying quality, was able to reassemble a coherent front of sorts. While on paper it looked like his new line could be successfully defended, Friesner feared that it would splinter when struck hard by Malinovsky's forces. The Hungarian regent, Admiral Miklos Horthy, and his supporters were also under no illusions as to which direction the wind was blowing, sensing that unless peace was made with the Soviet Union as soon as possible, their country would be destroyed in the fighting that would soon follow. While Friesner was frantically attempting to reconstruct the front line and marshal as many German and Hungarian divisions as possible to defend it, Horthy, through his representatives, was just as frantically trying to negotiate terms with one of Stalin's intermediaries. Although Horthy made every effort to keep these negotiations secret, these developments did not escape unnoticed in Berlin. Hitler made it clear to his subordinates that he would not tolerate Hungary changing sides like Romania and Bulgaria had the previous August. Hitler, the supreme commander of Germany's armed forces, felt that at this stage of the war, that if Hungary, with its strategic oil fields, natural resources, and large population, fell into enemy hands or joined with the Soviet Union, the war was as good as over. Notified by Friesner and other contacts of Horthy and his cabinet's conspiracy, Hitler, in his capacity as head of the OKW, ordered a preemptive strike in Budapest to be conducted on 15 October 1944 by two of his SS specialists, Obergruppenführer Erich von dem Bach and Obersturmbannführer Otto Skorzeny. Codenamed Unternehmen Panzerfaust, this SS-led task force initiated a coup that began with the kidnapping of Horthy's youngest son, Miklos Jr. This deed compelled the regent to resign his office and be taken to Germany as a guest when the SS threatened to kill his son unless Horthy gave in. The political vacuum that immediately ensued allowed Obergruppenführer von dem Bach, nicknamed the Butcher of Warsaw by the Poles, to quickly seize Budapest with a minimal amount of bloodshed. German troops rapidly took over all the key points in the city, including the telephone exchange, radio station, key bridges and road intersections, and confined the Hungarian army to its installations in the city. Before he was bundled away to Germany, Admiral Horthy, at Hitler's expressed order, dissolved his cabinet and installed a pro-German government led by the notorious Arrow Cross Party's leader, Ferenc Szálasi, a fascist who professed his guarantee to Hitler that Hungary would remain loyal until the bitter end, but who was little more than a puppet. To ensure that Szálasi's loyalty did not waver, actual control of the Hungarian government was entrusted to Brigadeführer Edmund Fessenmeier, whom Hitler appointed Reich plenipotentiary in Hungary after the German occupation. With his political flank now protected, Friesner's Heeresgruppe Süd could direct its attention to the heavy fighting that awaited. His army group situation had begun to improve by 15 October after several panzer divisions under the control of the commander of 8th Armee, General d'Artillerie Maximilian Freitapico, encircled and nearly destroyed three Soviet corps during the tank battle of Debrecen. Sensing an opportunity, Malinowski had sought to take advantage of the Hungarian government's disarray by incautiously splitting his forces and launching a daring drive towards Budapest on 6 October, though he did not have the accustomed overwhelming superiority that his front normally enjoyed. During the heavy fighting that took place from 10 to 15 October 1944, German and Hungarian forces managed to inflict significant damage to the 6th Guards Tank Army, which suffered the loss of over 200 tanks on 12 October alone. Although this counterattack stabilized the Hungarian front, it proved to be only a temporary reprieve, albeit one that gave the OKH and Heeresgruppe Süd time to evaluate the situation. Using this breathing space, Guderian, with Hitler's permission, ordered Friesner to pull his forces back to the Tisa River, a more defensible line than the one Heeresgruppe Süd had previously tried to hold. Viewing his defeat at Debrecen as only a temporary setback, Malinowski ordered the 6th Tank Army and Cavalry Mechanized Group Pleyev to closely pursue the withdrawing Axis divisions in hopes of encircling and destroying the bulk of their forces before they could cross the Danube. Too closely, as it proved. Taking advantage of the headlong Soviet advance, Freitapico's forces turned about on 23 October and conducted a pincer attack of their own, led by General der Panzertruppen Hermann Breit's 3rd Panzerkorps, cutting off and destroying three more Soviet corps by 26 October. This German-Hungarian victory brought major operations by both sides in Hungary to a halt until 28 October, the first time since mid-August that Friesner's army group had enjoyed a cohesive, though thinly occupied, front line. Taking advantage of this brief pause in operations, Friesner did everything he could to strengthen the new front along the Tisa, especially the reorganization of the Hungarian forces, which were in complete disarray by this point in the wake of the resignation or defection of many of its senior officers after Horthy's failed attempt to make a separate peace with Stalin. Additional German units, deemed more capable and reliable, were inserted into the line between Hungarian units to serve as Korsettenstange, or corset stays, to buttress the defense and deter their defection, as well as to ensure that their allies carried out their share of the burden in defending their own country. Malinowski resumed his offensive towards Budapest on 29 October, codenamed the Budapest Operation, having had time to concentrate his forces and replace the tanks he had lost the week before. The German front along the Tisa was soon pierced at several points by the 46th Army after the Hungarian 3rd Armee disintegrated under its hammer blows. With little to slow his army down, Lieutenant General Ivan Schlemmen's spearheads, with their left flank demarcated by the line of the Danube, had pushed west and north to a point only 10 kilometers away from the southeast suburbs of Budapest by 2 November. The following day, his tanks had broken through the city's outer defense line on the eastern side of the Danube, but a series of counterattacks from 4 to 5 November by the 8th and 22nd SS Cavalry Division, as well as the 13th Panzer Division, soon joined by two other panzer divisions, forced the 46th Army back. During this tank battle, fighting could clearly be heard in the distance by the city's population, who began to display signs of panic despite assurances from Arrow Cross members that the Red Army would never enter the city. Matters were made more complicated when a German engineer inadvertently ignited demolition charges emplaced on the Margareta Bridge over the Danube that linked the two sides of the city, Buda and Pest. The explosion heavily damaged the bridge and caused a portion of it to fall into the river, at a time when the German and Hungarian defenders needed this bridge more than ever. Neither did this engender much trust between the city's population and their German overseers, who believed that the Germans would sacrifice their beloved city to delay the Soviet advance, though the bridge's destruction was purely accidental. Despite the nearness of the Soviet vanguards, very little had been done by this point to fortify the city to prepare it to withstand a long siege, especially against an attack from the western bank of the Danube, should the Red Army seize a crossing site and attempt an envelopment. According to Friesner in his post-war account, during one of his visits to Budapest during this period, the city still seemed to have a peacetime atmosphere. He later wrote, "While in Budapest, I realized that the population had no clue about how serious the situation at the front was. Everywhere I was still seeing scenes of the deepest peace and, unfortunately, this poured some bitter drops into the festive cup for the victories at Debrecen." Between 11 and 22 November, Malinowski, using four of his armies, the 7th Guards, 27th, 40th, and 53rd, fought and maneuvered against determined German resistance, advancing along a broad front from the Tisza to the Danube, before finally closing up along the Danube south of Budapest by 25 November. On his right flank north of Budapest, the 4th Ukrainian Front struggled against a determined German defense, staged by General der Infanterie Otto Wöhler's 8th Armee in the eastern Matra Mountains of Slovakia, barely managing to push the Germans back as far as Miskwac after suffering heavy losses. On Malinowski's left flank to the south of Budapest, near Baja, Tolbuchin's 3rd Ukrainian Front initiated its own attack on 22 November, breaking out of the bridgeheads his troops had established over the Drava River at Apatin and Batina. Blasting through the thin German defenses arrayed in the Drava-Danube Triangle, Tolbuchin's 4th Guards and 57th Armies had seized the key city of Mohacs by 26 November, ripping open the flank of Heeresgruppe Süd's neighbor to the south, Heeresgruppe F, thereby opening the way to the Lake Balaton region, home of Germany's last substantial oil reserves. By 29 November, the historic city of Pech fell to Tolbuchin's spearheads, and 2 days later his 4th Guards Army arrived along the Danube, linking up with the 46th Army of Malinowski's 2nd Ukrainian Front on 1 December, thus creating a continuous front along the Danube from Mohacs to just a few kilometers short of Budapest. Neither Heeresgruppe Süd nor Heeresgruppe F had been able to do much to stop it, with their few reserves being switched from one crisis point to the next before another one broke out somewhere else, much like the fabled Dutch boy frantically trying to plug holes in a dike. The next round of fighting would happen along the southern and northern approaches to the city. As Tolbuchin's forces inexorably approached the area southwest of Lake Balaton, Malinowski's attention focused on Budapest. While the 46th Army crossed the Danube and struck out towards the northern end of Lake Balaton, the 7th Guards Army and 6th Guards Tank Army attacked north of Budapest, taking the key city of Hatvan by 5 December. By 8 December, these two armies had taken the town of Vac on the Danube, less than 30 kilometers north of the capital, while at the same time Tolbuchin's forces had completely closed up along the Margaretestellung, the Margaret position. This was to be the German and Hungarians' new main defensive position that ran along the line Lake Balaton to Stuhlweissenburg, Sekish Fehérvár to Lake Valencia, and was a natural defensive position southwest of Budapest. It was manned by the troops and tanks of 6th Armee, A Gruppe Frette Pico, a mixture of German and Hungarian units. Although they had originally intended to incorporate Budapest into its Hauptkampflinie, the defenders' lack of sufficient infantry to hold the portion of the Margaretestellung that stretched between the northeastern corner of Lake Valencia and the southwestern corner of Budapest would have fateful consequences 12 days later. With Malinowski's and Tolbuchin's armies concentrated north and south of the city, and hence unable to quickly come to the aid of one another, Generaloberst Guderian sensed another opportunity to strike at least one of the two Soviet spearheads in the flank and destroy it. As the OKH chief of the general staff, on 11 December, he ordered Friesner to concentrate three of his panzer divisions, the 3rd, 6th, and 8th panzer divisions, and three heavy tank battalions under the operational control of Breit's 3rd Panzer Corps as quickly as possible, and launch this counteroffensive, codenamed Unternehmen Spätlese, or Operation Late Harvest, within 2 or 3 days at the latest. However, Guderian and Friesner disagreed as to which Soviet concentration to attack, that in the north or in the south of the city. With the generals at loggerheads, Hitler intervened and chose the course of action favored by Friesner, who wished to launch the Spätlese counteroffensive towards the south between Lakes Balaton and Valencia, beginning on 17 December 1945. While Friesner was assembling his forces, the weather intervened and delayed preparations. Heavy rain and thawing conditions turned the Hungarian roads into ribbons of mud, making any kind of movement by armored vehicles, not to mention trucks and cars, extremely difficult. On Friesner's directive, the offensive was put off for several days until the temperature dropped and the roads hopefully froze solid again. By 17 December, it was still raining, and the roads had not improved, although the panzer divisions had been assembled and, except for the weather, everything was ready for the offensive to begin. In justification of his decision to delay the attack, Friesner wrote afterwards that sending the designated armored formations into an immediate attack in the mud could not be justified. It was crucial to wait for the frost in order to be able to operate away from only paved roads. While this was occurring, the 6th Guards Tank Army, operating north of the Danube despite the inclement weather, took the town of Zahi east of the Gran or Hron River on 14 December when its vanguards easily pushed through the ineffective defense offered by the SS Dierlewange Brigade, which had been shipped south from Slovakia to hold the line recently vacated by most of the 24th Panzer Division, which had left behind only a small Kampfgruppe. For the next 3 days, Guderian and Friesner argued back and forth about the urgency of launching Spätlese. Friesner was cautious, not wishing to sacrifice his carefully husbanded tanks, while Guderian, mindful of the big picture, urged his subordinate onwards as he watched the possibility of a quick victory begin to slip away. When Malinovsky's tanks from the 6th Guards Tank Army broke through the Berzhenyi Mountain south of Zahi and north of the Danube on 20 December, it created an existential threat to the survival of Heeresgruppe Süd. For on that same day, Tolbuchen's forces struck on either side of Lake Valencia. Hitler, for his part, was growing impatient and demanded action. With a crisis plainly unfolding before his eyes, Guderian, prodded by a Führerbefehl issued by Hitler the previous day, was forced to act. Ordering Friesner to leave the tanks behind with 3rd Panzer Corps of Fretapiko's 6th Armee to carry on with Spätlese, Guderian moved the division staffs and infantry components of the panzer divisions to the mountainous region south of Zahi, along the Gran River. Here, they could at least stop the advance of the Soviet tanks before they broke out into the Danubian plains northwest of Budapest that led to the gates of Vienna. Meanwhile, the panzer regiments and heavy tank battalions, nearly 400 panzers in all, operating under Breit's 3rd Panzer Corps, attempted to follow the Spätlese plan against Tolbuchen's forces, but their attacks met with little success. Churning through the mud, the German panzers used up massive amounts of scarce fuel as they attempted to maneuver against their more nimble opponent. The employment of these tank regiments and separate battalions proved to be a difficult challenge for Breit to command or control, since their accustomed division headquarters had been sent north of the Danube along with most of their signal battalions. The last-minute creation of Divisionsgruppe Papa on 21 December, an attempt to use the division commander and staff of the Panzergrenadierdivision Feldherrenhalle, or FHH, for this purpose, came too late to make much difference. Without adequate infantry support, These 10 tank battalions were easy prey for the Soviet infantry and anti-tank guns and were finally forced to withdraw behind the safety of the Margaretestellung, and Unternehmen Spätlese came to an inglorious end the following day, 22 December. Although Freitepikow's armored assault had achieved none of its goals, 3rd Panzer Corps' aborted offensive had at least limited the scope of the 2nd Ukrainian Front's advance due to excessive caution on the part of the Soviet commander. Providentially for the Germans and Hungarians, Malinovsky had evidently decided not to risk converting his front's penetration into a deep attack with so many panzers lurking about, but instead to conduct a shallow envelopment of Budapest from the west, which would seal the fate of the city's defenders. That same day, Friesner took the opportunity to request permission to withdraw the troops of the 9th SS Gebirgskorps from Freitepikow's 6th Armee defending Budapest on the eastern bank of the Danube, a move that he believed would free up a badly needed infantry division but would also result in the abandonment of Pest. This Hitler categorically refused to consider, believing it important to hold the eastern side of the city for political reasons. Budapest would continue to be held at all costs. By this point, both Hitler and Guderian had lost patience with Friesner and Freitepikow, leaders whom they judged to be too cautious and lacking in the kind of fighting spirit that the extreme situation required. Consequently, on the night of 22 December, Friesner and Freitepikow were notified by the operations branch of OKH that they would both be relieved of their commands within the next 24 hours. The new commander of Heeresgruppe Süd would henceforth be General der Infanterie Wöhler, formerly commander of 8th Armee, while Freitepikow, commander of 6th Armee, would be replaced on 24 December by General der Panzertruppen Hermann Balk, who would be brought over from the Western Front, where he had been commanding Heeresgruppe G. At least Wöhler was familiar with the situation, having commanded the 8th Armee since August 1943, so his elevation to command of the army group would be relatively seamless. Balk, on the other hand, had been fighting on the Western Front for the past 3 months, and although he was an Eastern Front veteran, would need to quickly orient himself in regards to his new duties and responsibilities. While the Germans dithered, Malinovsky and Tolbuchin relentlessly pushed forward. Though neither of these commanders possessed the strategic or operational talents of other more gifted Soviet commanders, such as Zhukov, Konev, or Rokossovsky, they were good at following orders from the Stavka and were certainly up to the challenge of commanding army groups in a region of limited operational scope such as Hungary. Wherever the Germans displayed weakness, they exploited it. Where their enemy showed strength, they went around it or crushed him with overwhelming firepower. On 23 December, 4th Guards Army took the city of Bichka against negligible resistance, thus severing all ground communications with Budapest. The following day, Wöhler, echoing his predecessor in command, telephoned Guderian at OKH and briefed him on the deteriorating situation. Wöhler requested that he be given the authority to order the city's garrison to evacuate the eastern bank of the Danube and move into the inner defensive ring on the west bank of the Danube, which comprised the Buda portion of the city. This was, ironically, the same position that Friesner had also advocated, and was one of the factors that had led to his abrupt dismissal. Surprisingly, Guderian did not reject his plea outright, but informed him that he would pass his request on to Hitler, who, upon being notified of the Heeresgruppe Süd commander's request, characteristically refused to consider any mention of a withdrawal. Hitler had previously designated Budapest a Festung, or fortress, on 1 December, and as such, it would be defended to the last man and the last round of ammunition. Soviet tanks reached the city of Gran, or Estergom, on 26 December. Budapest was now completely encircled. Although on paper the defending German-Hungarian force appeared strong, it lacked sufficient food, fuel, and ammunition for the 70,000-man garrison led by SS-Obergruppenführer Karl Pfeffer Wildenbruch, commander of the 9th SS Gebirgskorps, and was hardly in any shape to withstand a long siege. As for the city's population of nearly 800,000 men, women, and children, no food or fuel had been stockpiled for them at all, other than what they had managed to hoard on their own initiative. To rescue the city and its garrison, a relief operation would have to be launched immediately. The only consolation, if there was one, was that a panzer corps was being hurriedly brought down from Poland at that very moment to lead the relief effort, and that corps was none other than Gille's 4th SS Panzer Corps. Dorfmühlen to the Juliska, indeed. At this point, members of Gille's corps can be forgiven for wondering why they were being shipped so hastily to Hungary. After all, they might have asked, was not the Führer always right? Were things not going according to plan? And was the tide not finally turning back to favor Germany? According to all official communiques, the mighty Wehrmacht had stopped the Allies at the Gothic line in Italy. The Red Army was being held at bay in Poland, Courland, and East Prussia, and various wonder weapons, such as the V-1 and V-2, were already pounding the British Isles. According to the same reports, the Kriegsmarine was sinking record numbers of enemy ships. The Luftwaffe's new jet aircraft were systematically shooting down the enemy's air fleets of flying fortresses and liberators, and Germany's enemies were suffering crippling losses everywhere. New tanks, aircraft, and U-boats were rolling off the assembly lines in numbers never before imagined, and new units, such as Volksgrenadier divisions, were being activated by the dozens. Most of all, Nazi media outlets were reporting that the Wacht am Rhein offensive in the Ardennes seemed to be going according to plan, with American and British armies routed and thousands of prisoners taken. Antwerp was almost in the bag, though there was a bit of fighting at some place called Bastogne. Even in Hungary, the Red Army had reportedly suffered severe reversals, while hundreds of thousands of German troops had been successfully evacuated from Greece and Yugoslavia. At least, that is the impression a naive young soldier would take away from viewing the latest newsreel of Die Deutsche Wochenschau in the cinema, scanning the newest Signal magazine, or reading Das Schwarze Korps newspaper. So why was it necessary to send the 4th SS Panzer Corps to Hungary? Well, no doubt glad to be leaving the wet triangle in Poland, even veteran SS officers and enlisted men must have believed that when the time came, their divisions would be fighting on Germany's eastern borders to prevent Stalin's so-called Bolshevik hordes from entering their homeland, not serving in a backwater of a front in southeastern Europe. If Obergruppenführer Gille had felt any such doubts, he did not express them, but instead seems to have been focused exclusively on the mission ahead of him and the important role his corps would play in the upcoming relief operation, as he always did. Though seemingly illogical, there was method in Hitler's madness. While most of his military advisers, including Guderian, thought the emphasis should be on preparing to repel the impending Soviet winter offensive against eastern Germany expected after 12 January 1945, Hitler had decided that the Hungarian theater of operations was where the war would be won or lost. After being forced to abandon the vast Romanian oil fields at Plesti 4 months before, Hungary's rather modest oil fields at Nagykanizsa were soon producing more oil than any other source within Hitler's shrinking empire, including the synthetic oil production facilities in Germany that had been badly damaged by the American 8th Air Force. Although paltry by contemporary American industry standards, the 600,000 tons of oil pumped out of the Nagykanizsa fields that year, combined with a much smaller amount from Austria's Zitzendorf wells, provided nearly 80% of Germany's remaining oil production by late 1944. Without oil to refine into petroleum and associated byproducts, there would be no fuel for the new tanks, aircraft, and submarines rolling off the assembly lines. Without these powerful weapons, Germany's war was as good as lost. So there was some logic to Hitler's single-minded focus on Hungary. To Hitler, not only was it vital to relieve Budapest, the capital city of his last significant ally and an important political objective itself, but the oil fields at Nagykanizsa had to be protected at all costs. There was also the 730,000 tons of steel that Hungary shipped to Germany every year, a not insignificant amount, considering Albert Speer's drive to increase armaments production. To Hitler's way of thinking, holding on to Hungary was just as important towards winning the war as was the Ardennes or Alsace offensives. Consequently, what few mobile reserves Germany could still spare on the Eastern Front at that particular moment would be sent to Heeresgruppe Süd, including Gille's corps. As soon as the Wacht am Rhein offensive was successfully concluded and the Allied armies in the west destroyed, the SS Panzer Army operating under the command of SS Obergruppenführer Sepp Dietrich would then be shipped to the east to play its part in the next act of the drama unfolding between Budapest and Vienna. To buttress the case that Hitler made, his viewpoint was backed up by the chief of staff of the OKW, Generalfeldmarschall Wilhelm Keitel, and the chief of his OKW operations staff, Generaloberst Alfred Jodl, two men who usually agreed on everything that Der Führer said. Against this coalition, Guderian was able to make little headway. In the end, two of the Ostfront's 14.5 Panzer or Panzergrenadier divisions remaining on the Eastern Front were shipped to Hungary at the end of December 1944, leaving only 12.5 mechanized divisions as the reserve to reinforce an enormous front line stretching over 800 kilometers from the Carpathian Mountains in the south to the Baltic Sea coast in the north. In comparison, the much smaller Hungarian Front had 7 of these powerful formations and would soon gain 4 more when the 6th Panzer Armee was transferred from the Western Front at the end of February 1945, which would, by that point, amount to nearly 18% of all the armored formations in the entire Wehrmacht and Waffen-SS order of battle. This leads to the final question, which was, why was it deemed necessary to transfer the 4th SS Panzer Corps to carry out the relief operation when other similar reserves were available that were not already committed at the front, unlike Gille's Corps? To understand why, one must first examine a number of factors that were in play between 20 and 25 December 1944. The idea of relieving Budapest was first discussed at a meeting held at the Adlerhorst, Hitler's supreme headquarters in Ziegenberg, on Christmas Eve 1944, the day Bitschke fell. As early as 20 December, it was already apparent to everyone in attendance, including Hitler, Keitel, Jodl, and Guderian, as well as Heinrich Himmler, that Budapest would soon be surrounded. At the meeting on 24 December, Guderian aired his opinion that Budapest should be given up, with the forces holding the city allowed to break out and used instead to form a new defense line west of the city. The reasons why he advocated this course of action were clear to him, at least, for he favored reinforcing the Eastern Front at the expense of every other front, including withdrawing forces from the Ardennes, which by 23 December already appeared to have little chance of succeeding. He also wanted to withdraw as many divisions from the Brückenkopf Kurland, or Kurland Bridgehead, as possible, where Heeresgruppe Nord had been completely bottled up in the Lithuanian peninsula since 9 October 1944. Guderian's driving motivation, above all, was to prepare his theater of operations to resist the massive Soviet offensive expected in early January and to prevent the Red Army from penetrating Germany's eastern heartland. This, he believed, is where the war would be won or lost, not in Hungary. For the reasons stated, Hitler overruled his chief of the OKH and ordered Festung Budapest to hold out until relieved, much to Guderian's disappointment. Despite his protests, the meeting concluded when Hitler told Guderian that the OKH theater of operations, the Eastern Front, consisting of Heeresgruppe Süd, A, Mitte, and Nord, would have to take care of itself for the foreseeable future. Since Heeresgruppe Süd's 3 armies, the 3rd Ungarisch, 6th, and 8th Armee, lacked sufficient mobile forces of their own to both hold their current positions, including protecting the vital Nachkanija oil fields, and fight their way through the 2nd or 3rd Ukrainian fronts to relieve Budapest, Wöhler's army group would obviously have to be reinforced with an additional panzer corps, but not one from the Western Front. That corps was to be Gille's. The choice was Hitler's and Hitler's alone. One of the reasons why he picked it was due to its proximity on the map. It was in the Heeresgruppe Mitte area of operations and could be moved by rail relatively quickly. This choice may have been supported by the fact that the Nara-Vistula sector had been relatively static for the past 2 months, so Hitler might have felt that he was incurring little risk, despite Guderian's arguments to the contrary. Additionally, the Totenkopf division was in a position behind the front lines acting as the 2nd Armee Armored Reserve, so it was available for immediate movement. Perhaps the deciding factor was that Hitler knew that Gille had successfully commanded troops during the breakout from the Cherkasy pocket a year earlier, and had done the same during the Battle of Koval, where he took command of a demoralized and disorganized garrison and led the defense of the city until it was relieved 3 weeks later. Hitler had personally bestowed the swords to Gille's Knight's Cross with oak leaves for his deeds at Cherkasy on 20 February 1944, and the diamonds for his performance of duty at Koval 2 months later. So the dictator knew Gille both by reputation and by sight, important factors in Hitler's way of assessing leadership. Gille, Hitler thought, would know the mentality of encircled troops better than anyone. The mere mention of his name in connection with a relief force, the thinking went, would be enough to bolster the morale of the troops holding Festung Budapest and would encourage them to hold out until relieved. According to Georg Meyer, former 1A of the 6th Panzer Armee, the garrison of Budapest was informed by radio that Gille and the 4th SS Panzer Corps was being brought in. From that point on, the name Gille brought new hope to the besieged, from the senior commander to the lowest grenadier. This knowledge and their faith in their approaching comrades who would relieve them allowed those surrounded by the enemy to endure, even in the most apparently hopeless of circumstances. It also gave them the courage and strength to patiently bear the heaviest physical and spiritual burdens as they bravely defended Budapest, fighting to the last round. Although Hitler's judgment in this matter can be questioned, his reasoning was shared by Obergruppenführer Felix Steiner, who wrote afterwards that it had been said of the commanding general of the 4th SS Panzer Corps that he had already been in a pocket once, and he would know better than anyone else the mood of his surrounded comrades. For this reason, he and his forces were especially well suited for the relief of Budapest. As if to remove all doubt, Heinrich Himmler himself sent a telegram to Gille on 24 December within hours of receipt of the original alert order that stated, "The Führer has directed you to carry out the relief of Budapest with your corps. The justification of this decision is based on the fact that you have already proven that you and your corps can successfully relieve encircled units." The head of the dreaded SS Empire then closed with the ominous line, "The Führer expects you and your corps to relieve Budapest, and I personally expect that you will not disappoint me." Once they had detected the movement of Gille's corps several days later, the Anglo-American intelligence staff, bolstered with special intelligence provided by Ultra, were mystified as to why the Germans had switched their last remaining armored reserve on the Eastern Front from Poland to Hungary, especially when the Germans themselves acknowledged that the Soviet winter offensive in Poland was only weeks, if not days, away. Not content with holding the Russians west of the city of Budapest, the Germans made frantic efforts to batter their way through to relieve it. In order to do so, they not only fatally denuded other fronts, but also uselessly shattered a powerful armored force which would have been very helpful in the Hungarian offensive of March 1945. Regardless of the logic of the decision, the die was cast, and until the end of the war, the 4th SS Panzer Corps would fight with Heeresgruppe Süd. Chapter 3. Arrival in Hungary, 25 to 28 December 1944. As related in the previous chapter, formal orders from OKH in Sossen transferring the 4th SS Panzer Corps and all of its subunits to Hungary were received via Hellschreiber at Gille's headquarters in Modlin at 6 p.m. on 24 December 1944. The Corps' units, including the Totenkopf and Wiking Panzer divisions, which were in the midst of preparations for celebrating the Christmas holidays, had to cancel their plans and immediately begin preparing for their imminent transfer by rail to the Hungarian Theater of Operations, codenamed Juliska. Combat activity on Christmas Eve had been relatively minimal, allowing most of 4th SS Panzer Corps' units to continue their preparations for their rail movement to Hungary undisturbed. However, during the early hours of Christmas Day, the Soviet 186th and 250th Rifle Divisions of the 47th Army each launched a battalion-sized probing attack in the Vestland Regiment sector at Kotomov and Kawushin. Both attempts to penetrate the Vestland Regiment's defenses were driven off by artillery and small arms fire without any German ground being lost or suffering any casualties worth mentioning. However, it was more than a minor affair. The scale of the German response can be adjudged by the 4th SS Panzer Corps' expenditure of artillery ammunition that day, which amounted to 37 tons, nearly twice the Corps' average for that particular period of the war. After the failure of their reconnaissance in force attempt, neither Soviet division made any further effort that day. Today, after 75 years have gone by, it is unclear whether the 1st Belorussian Front had become aware of the impending transfer of Gille's corps. Perhaps both attacks were thinly veiled efforts to tie up and prevent the Vestland Regiment from pulling out, or just another example of the well-established record of Soviet commanders determined to seize prisoners for interrogation, especially along a static front. According to Ultra Intercepts, the Anglo-American Special Intelligence Branch was unaware of anything out of the ordinary taking place and would not notice the transfer of the 4th SS Panzer Corps for another week. Despite the convoluted manner of Hitler's decision-making process in prioritizing which front would receive reinforcements and selecting which corps would be sent to assist in the relief of Budapest, this was a simple matter compared to the physical process of moving a corps of nearly 40,000 men, 421 armored vehicles, including inoperable ones, and at least 4,544 soft-skinned wheeled and tracked vehicles of all types by rail in less than a week. In addition to their vehicles and other equipment, Gille's troops also had to load over 250 individual heavy weapons, including artillery pieces, anti-aircraft and anti-tank guns, and rocket projectors, as well as hundreds of trailers. Since there would be no food, fuel, or ammunition immediately available upon arrival in Hungary until 4th SS Panzer Corps could connect with the logistics and administrative apparatus of 6th Armee, the Corps and its affiliated units had to bring along everything they had, including at least 3 days' worth of bulk rations, not counting emergency iron rations, 94,761 gallons of fuel, both gasoline and diesel, not counting what was already in each vehicle's fuel tanks, and 4,544 tons of all types of munitions, ranging from 9mm pistol rounds to 15cm artillery ammunition. To complicate matters, loading all of these combat vehicles and other pieces of heavy equipment would all have to be done manually, in freezing weather, and with inadequate lighting at night. Still, it would be done in record time, though how many men were accidentally killed or injured during the loading process is not recorded. Evidence indicates that Ultra finally did detect the movement of 4th SS Panzer Corps to relieve Budapest on 2 January 1945, the day after the operation began, when it intercepted and decoded the following radio message from Himmler's liaison office with Hitler, Gruppenführer Hermann Fegelein, described by the officer writing the Ultra history of the war on the Eastern Front as a colorful racketeer. On that day, Fegelein had wired Obergruppenführer Pfeffer Wildenbruch heartiest good wishes for the new year. The Führer appreciates your exemplary behavior. Gille comes on apace. As the Ultra report on the message stated, this was rather startling, that the Germans, knowing that a Soviet offensive was imminent in central Poland, were yet prepared to switch to the Budapest front. Their only effective armored reserve for meeting that offensive was a measure of the importance they attached to the southern fighting. With the Corps' departure from the Warsaw Front proceeding at a rapid pace, the sector held by Viking Division would have to be completely turned over to the 73rd Infanterie Division as quickly as possible. As for the Totenkopf Division, its role of serving as the 2nd Armee Armored Reserve would be fulfilled by the understrength 7th Panzer Division, which was also undergoing a rest and reconstitution period behind the lines. Because Obergruppenführer Gille's corps headquarters, the Totenkopf Division, and Kampfgruppe Dor were deemed as being immediately available for movement, these units began loading for rail transport as early as 25 December, with the first train departing late that evening. With Obergruppenführer Gille's corps headquarters and its signal battalion departing, this meant that the Viking Division would have to be temporarily placed under the tactical control of 36th Panzerkorps of the 9th Armee, until it could be relieved east of Modlin and join the rest of the corps in Hungary. The commander of the 73rd Infantry Division, Generalmajor Schlieper, was notified as early as the evening of 25 December by 9th Armee that his troops would have to relieve the Viking Division, which meant that he would have to move his division, battalion by battalion, across the Vistula, using the bridges at Modlin and Nový Dvor, to carry out this new mission. His division's former sector, north of Warsaw, would be taken over by Speerbrigade 1 on the night of 27 to 28 December. This brigade, which had been attached to the 8th Armée Corps until 26 December, was not an infantry unit at all, but consisted primarily of various combat engineer units called from the entire 9th Armée area of operations, with a sprinkling of artillery, anti-aircraft, and anti-tank units in support. Since it was defending a portion of the west bank of the wide Vistula south of Warsaw, it had to be quickly pulled out of the line and shipped to the area north of the ruined city, while a neighboring division was forced to stretch its own front lines to compensate for the brigade's departure, thus weakening that portion of the front even further. The 9th Armee commander, General der Panzertruppe Smilo Freiherr von Lüttwitz, was caught completely off guard by the sudden transfer of Gille's corps from the neighboring 2nd Armee. Even more surprising was the accompanying directive to take over the defense of the Narrow-Vistula Triangle, which he must have thought his army was finally rid of on 26 November 1944. In his commander's report that evening, he complained bitterly to the commander of Heeresgruppe A, Generaloberst Josef Harpe, telling him that he simply did not have enough forces to carry out this added responsibility. In particular, he brought to his commander's attention the enormous disparity in combat power between the departing Viking and the 73rd Infantry Division, which had only recently been rebuilt following its total collapse on 12 September 1944 during the Second Defensive Battle of Warsaw. In the same evening report, General der Panzertruppe von Lüttwitz informed his army group commander that it was imperative to reinforce the weak 73rd Infanterie Division to the point where it would be able to successfully hold the new sector being vacated by the Viking Division on its own, should the Soviet 47th Army launch a major attack, but that at the present time, his army had no assets of its own to spare. To do this, he felt, Heeresgruppe A would need to provide additional assets so von Lüttwitz could reinforce Schlieper's division with at least one Heeresartillerieabteilung, a pioneer battalion, and an assault guns brigade, with at least two batteries to compensate for the loss of the Viking Division's panzer regiment. Despite von Lüttwitz's pleas for additional forces, they fell on deaf ears, for Harpe had other defensive priorities that ranked higher than holding the Vistula-Narov triangle that demanded what few reserves his army group did possess. Ironically, less than a month later, Harpe was proven correct when the Great Soviet Winter Offensive began, sweeping the forces of Heeresgruppe Mitte and the 9th Armee from Heeresgruppe A before them and forcing the hasty abandonment of the Vistula-Narov triangle almost without a fight. While the commander of 9th Armee haggled with his army group commander for more forces, the transfer of 4th SS Panzer Corps in the 2nd Armee area of operations continued apace. To enable the movement of the 4th SS Panzer Corps, Heeresgruppe Mitte tasked 2nd Armee to arrange transportation using railheads in its own area of operations, which occupied the efforts of the staff officers responsible for arranging transportation for nearly a week. Hundreds of special rail cars for tanks, Other armored vehicles, trucks, and troops had to be marshaled from all over Eastern and Southeastern Europe, involving nearly 100 locomotives, but all were brought together in a remarkably short amount of time. Within less than 30 hours of receipt of the initial order on the evening of 24 December 1944, the first trains carrying troops from the Totenkopf division were already rolling towards Hungary, an amazing feat in itself. Between 26 and 31 December, the Corps Hauptquartier, SS Nachrichtenabteilung 104, other corps troops, and most of its two divisions entrained for Hungary. They used over 164 trains from as many as 50 different rail-loading sites in the 2nd Armee Rückwärtiges Armeegebiet, or rear area. To do this, they used nearly every possible rail yard or loading ramp in the cities of Modling, Chișinău, Nasilsk, Plönen, Milau, and Schrottersburg, as well as from many tiny rail sidings in numerous villages and towns located along the rail line. The new assignment came so suddenly and so unexpectedly that many members of the Corps and its two divisions were left behind, or nearly so. Hauptsturmführer Hans Flügel, who was at home in Germany on holiday leave, received a surreptitious telephone call, a gross violation of operational security considering the secrecy surrounding the transfer, informing him about the new mission. He hurriedly packed, said goodbye to his family, and departed the same day on a civilian passenger train to catch up with his battalion, 2nd Abteilung SS-Panzerregiment 5, part of Kampfgruppe Dor, before it departed for Hungary on the evening of 26 December. Late in the evening on 25 December, the first element of the Totenkopf division, SS-Panzeraufklärung Abteilung 3, departed on its Blitztransport, or express journey, to Hungary. The 700-kilometer roundabout trip took them through Bromberg, Posen, Breslau, and Vienna before finally arriving at the end of the line between Rapp and Komorn, Kumarum, on 28 December. Most of the troops traveled in unheated passenger cars, if they were lucky, or in freight cars if they were not. At various whistle stops along the way, commanders would allow their troops to disembark, stretch their legs, and be served a hot meal by Betreuungs, or troop welfare units. If any of the passengers brought along tobacco or alcoholic beverages, both would be passed around to help relieve the cold and monotony of the nearly 48-hour journey. With the Corps headquarters' departure, on that same day, the 46th Panzer Corps assumed tactical control of the Viking Division, as well as the responsibility for defending the Wet Triangle, at 8 a.m. For 3 days at least, Ulrich's division would be once again under the command of von Luttwitz's 9th Armee. Wednesday, 27 December, was the last date that the 4th SS Panzer Corps reported to the headquarters of 2nd Armee. It was a cold and cloudy day, with temperatures hovering slightly below freezing, making life miserable for the men stationed at the various railheads loading vehicles and equipment. The Korpsführungsabteilung hastily tied up loose ends and prepared to vacate the old fortress at Modling. The Corps communications link remained active until Obergruppenführer Gille was informed by Generaloberst Weiss that at 1 minute after midnight on 28 December, his corps would initially fall under the command authority of Heeresgruppe Süd until it reached its final destination. The signalers then reeled in their cables, packed up their equipment, and headed for the rail station to join the rest of the Hauptquartier, where Hauptsturmführer Zachmann, the headquarters commandant, was ensuring everyone was accounted for. Kampfgruppe Dor from the Viking Division, which had been serving as the Corps reserve a few kilometers northwest of Modling, began its own rail movement to Komorn that day. Obersturmbannführer Dor's battle group consisted of his regimental headquarters and regimental companies of his Germania regiment, as well as its 1st, 2nd, and 3rd Bataillone, and all operational panzers of SS-Panzerregiment 5 Kampfgruppe Dor would be the first element of the Viking Division committed to battle less than a week later. The movement of corps troops was no small matter either. In addition to the Hauptquartier in Modling, its supporting Corps Signals Battalion, SS Corps Nachrichtenabteilung 104, its Corps Artillery Headquarters, SS Arco 104, and Anti-Aircraft Battery, SS Flakabteilung 104, as well as the Corps' other Corps Truppen, SS-Werferabteilung 504, SS-Sanitätsabteilung 504, SS-Feldlazarett 504, and its supply and transport column, SS-Kraftfahr Company 104, also had to pack up all of their vehicles and equipment and head to their designated railheads. Since the Corps' Quartiermeister and Adjutantur staff sections were located in Plönen and not in Modlin, they would have to travel separately. All told, nearly 2,500 Corps troops, with the Führungsabteilung, or the operations and intelligence staffs, in the lead, made the same journey as the Corps' two divisions, reaching the town of Utch, 10 kilometers southwest of Komorn, by 1 January 1945, where they unloaded. Upon arriving in Utch, the Corps' signal battalion would immediately begin laying wire and locating the best locations in the town to position its array of radio antennae, while the Corps adjutant, Sturmbannführer Schulze, worked alongside with the headquarters commandant, seeking out suitable living quarters, work areas for the staff and Corps troops, and parking areas for their array of motor vehicles. Gille himself and his chief of staff, including several other officers and a small security detail in a second staff car, drove from Modlin to the headquarters of Balk's 6th Armee at Martinsburg, modern-day Pannonhalma, on Christmas Day to be apprised of his corps' new mission as well as to get a sense of the overall military situation. That same day, to mark the corps' departure, Generaloberst Reinhardt of Heeresgruppe Mitte issued a Tagesbefehl praising Obergruppenführer Gille and his two divisions for their performance while under his command. Today, the 4th SS Panzer Corps and the SS Panzer Divisions Totenkopf and Wiking depart from the sphere of command of Army Group Center. The two SS Panzer Divisions first came to the Army Group during the desperate hours marking the beginning of the summer of 1944, and through their exemplary bravery, displayed first on the battlefields at Grodno and Brest-Litovsk, and in early August, under the command of the glorious defender of Kovel, through the Soviet summer offensive back from the gates of Warsaw in a victorious tank battle and erected an impenetrable wall to prevent the Red Flood from breaking through, in the heavy defensive battles that followed between the Vistula and Bug rivers, the SS Corps displayed exemplary steadfastness and combat readiness and successfully threw back repeated assaults by an overwhelmingly superior enemy force, which then set the proper conditions for the establishment of a solid German defensive front on the southern flank of East Prussia. Since I must bid farewell to the 4th SS Panzer Corps and its two brave SS Panzer Divisions today, I want to extend to them my personal gratitude and let them know of my genuine recognition of their magnificent feat of arms. May my best wishes accompany your leaders and troops towards their new and difficult assignment. Signed, Reinhardt, Commander, Army Group Center, 27 December, 1944. That day also marked the moment when at 10 p.m., the headquarters of the 27th Armee Corps took over the sector north of the Narev, previously held by 4th SS Panzer Corps, when Gille's Gefechtstand began moving to Hungary. Command and control of the Heeres divisions under its banner, the 35th and 252nd Infantry Division and the 542nd Volksgrenadier Division, now became the responsibility of this neighboring corps, which had to extend its own span of control significantly. All of the Heerestruppen supporting Gille's corps remained behind with the 2nd Armee, including the heavy artillery battalions, rocket launcher brigade, engineer battalions, and units responsible for rear area security. The 4th SS Panzer Corps would be allotted new ones once it arrived in the 6th Armee area of operations. In addition to the changes already mentioned, the regimental headquarters of Grenadier Regiment 70 from the 73rd Infantry Division arrived in Modlin that same day and assumed responsibility for commanding the forces deployed in the Wet Triangle, taking over from the regimental headquarters of the Westland, freeing up Obersturmbannführer Franz Hack and his staff to begin moving to the nearest rail yard. The 1st Bataillon Westland, 1st Bataillon SS Panzer Grenadier Regiment Norge, and 1st Bataillon SS Panzer Grenadier Regiment Denmark had to temporarily remain in place, while they took direction from the commander of Grenadier Regiment 70. They would not have to wait long. At the same time, 1st Abteilung SS Panzer Artillery Regiment Viking was relieved by 2nd Abteilung Artillery Regiment 173, SS Panzer Pioneer Bataillon 5 by Pioneer Bataillon 173, and SS Panzer Jäger Abteilung 5 by Panzer Jäger Abteilung 173. All of these units began moving according to plan to the nearest local railheads to start loading for movement to Hungary. On 28 December, the first elements of the 4th SS Panzer Corps, Sturmbannführer Pellens SS Panzer Aufklärung Abteilung 3, began arriving at the rail station in Rap, Győr, Hungary, where his men immediately started unloading their vehicles and equipment. This also marked the day when the main body of the Hauptquartier of the 4th SS Panzer Corps arrived at the railroad yard in Acz, a town southwest of Komorn. On the same day in Poland, the 73rd Infantry Division formally took control of the sector formerly held by the Viking Division. In the Wet Triangle, the 1st Bataillon SS Panzer Grenadier Regiment Denmark was relieved in the front lines by 1st Bataillon Grenadier Regiment 186 of the 73rd Infantry Division. By this point, all but two battalions of the Viking Division had handed over their positions to the incoming units from the 73rd Infantry Division, thereby allowing these battalions to join the main body of the division in the rail movement over the next several days. On 29 December, Sturmbannführer Vogt's 1st Bataillon SS Panzer Grenadier Regiment Norge was finally relieved in the line by 2nd Bataillon Grenadier Regiment 186 and began marching to Modlin to board its awaiting train. His troops had been occupying defensive positions for over a month by this point, but had seen little combat except for intermittent shelling, sniper fire, and small-scale night raids by their opponents. Fusilier Bataillon 173 began its relief of Sturmbannführer Nederhoff's 1st Bataillon Westland after midnight. By the following day, 30 December, the relief in place of 1st Bataillon Westland was complete, marking the point when the last of the Viking Division's constituent elements were disengaged and loaded on trains for movement to Hungary. At the same time that Obergruppenführer Gille's 4th SS Panzer Corps and his two divisions were moving towards their new area of operations, two other divisions from the Heer, designated to join up with the Corps, were notified that they would also be shipped to Hungary. Each would depart from separate theaters of operation. The 96th Infantry Division from Heeresgruppe A near Tarnow in the Beskids Mountains, and the 711th Infantry Division from Heeresgruppe B Reserve in Holland, where it had recently undergone reconstitution to bring it back up to its authorized strength. The 96th Infantry Division would unload at Komorn, west of the confluence of the Gran or Hron and Danube rivers, and move into a forward assembly area encompassing the towns of Butz, Karva, and Musla. The 711th Infantry Division would do the same at various railroad stations in the Rab and Komorn area before moving to its forward assembly area near Tokod. Neither division had ever worked before under Gille's command, but both formations would enjoy good working relationships with the Corps and were a welcome addition to the 4th SS Panzer Corps order of battle, bringing badly needed foot soldiers to the upcoming operation. When Gille's headquarters received the unexpected news of the transfer of 4th SS Panzer Corps to Hungary, an equally important development was unfolding that would also have a decisive impact on the Corps' future. Since Generaloberst Freta Pico, the hapless commander of 6th Armee, had been sacked on 22 December for his alleged bungling of Operation Spätlese, he would have to be replaced immediately by someone Hitler trusted who could lead the Budapest relief operation, which was to be primarily a 6th Armee mission. That someone was the aforementioned General der Panzertruppe Hermann Balk. For the next 4 months, the fates of Gille, his corps, and that of Balk would be intertwined, for better or worse. Before proceeding, though, a brief background on the career of the brilliant and controversial Balk is in order. Born on 7 December 1893 in Danzig, Balk came from a distinguished military family, his father being Generalleutnant William Balk, a noted tactician of the Kaiserheer. After attending the military academy in Hanover, he served as an infantry officer in World War I, fighting on the Eastern, Western, Italian, and Balkan fronts. Highly decorated, he was wounded in action 6 times, and by the war's end had been promoted to Leutnant, one of the few officers selected to form the new Reichswehr in 1920. Balk served primarily in cavalry and mountain infantry units, rising from platoon leader to battalion commander. By 1933, a member of Hitler's new Wehrmacht, Balk had risen to the rank of Oberstleutnant by 1938, based on his outstanding performance in helping to develop Panzertroop doctrine and tactics. From that point on, his career progressed rapidly. While commanding a motorized infantry regiment of the 1st Panzer Division, he led it with distinction throughout the Battle of France in 1940 and was promoted to Oberst later that year. From 1941 to 44, he commanded in succession Panzerbrigade II, 11th Panzer Division, Panzergrenadier Division Großdeutschland, 14th Panzer Corps, 48th Panzer Corps, and 4th Panzer Armee during fighting in Greece, the Soviet Union, Italy, and Poland. During this same period, he progressed in rank from Oberst to General der Panzertruppe, earning a reputation as a highly talented tactician and a strict taskmaster, who insisted that his orders be carried out swiftly and faithfully. Frequently hailed as a bold and decisive leader.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.